Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our Sports and Society event on paying college athletes. My name is Jan Bach-Steffensmeyer. I'm the Divisional Dean for Social and Behavioral Sciences in the College of Arts and Sciences. And I want to thank our renowned panel and the moderators of both sessions, all of whom are committed to analyzing this complex issue and giving solid recommendations for solutions. Sports and Society is an honest broker on these issues that come up in sports. I'm a political scientist by training, so I like to say we're nonpartisan on these issues, but we want to provide a platform to be able to discuss these very important topics. I want to take a moment to personally thank the people who made today possible. Trevon Logan, our professor in economics, and Lucia Dunn, also in economics, are the co-directors of Sports and Society. Professors Nicole Kraft and Chris Noster, as faculty advisory board members, played a big role, and Larry Baum is another faculty member from political science who is here with us today. Maddie Kerma is ASC special events coordinator and worked tirelessly to help us. I want to thank Mike Kaler and Alan Coleman of ASC Tech and our friends at Bartha for their AV support. We will have this up on our website for you to watch later. We also have a panel that we did earlier this fall on pay to play at the high school level that is up there available too. I want to thank the Faculty Club for hosting us in this event, and Jen Razor, my associate to the dean and right-hand person who helped make all this possible. My proud smile today is because it was about a year ago when I started as divisional dean, when I went to visit the economics faculty, and Lucia Dunn had the suggestion that Ohio State is preeminent in sports. We should also be preeminent in research on sports. So that is our goal in creating Sports and Society. After some follow-up discussions, Professor Logan decided to join Lucia in co-directing this year. And Dean Manderscheid at Arts and Sciences has been a big supporter in helping us get this going. Due to a lot of dedicated people, both around the university and our alumni around the country, we have a very impressive alumni board and list of affiliated faculty who are most impressive and I think are on the flyers that we have available today. So I want to welcome all the board members and the faculty who are with us. Sports and Society has a variety of dimensions to it, including courses that are of interest to our students in this area. So Lucia and Trevon have taught the sports economics for a number of years here at Ohio State. Chris has taught sociology of sports, and that will be some of the themes that we hit on next year with race and gender in sports. So we're not shying away from the controversial topics, I would say, as witnessed today. And I'm very happy to say Professor Nicole Kraft has started a sports media class, something that was very much needed at Ohio State, and of course enrollment is burgeoning through the roof on that as well. We've been very busy the last few months. We had a kickoff event in October. As I mentioned, our first panel was on pay to play, who's in, who's out, and how much. And we also followed up with, in December, having one of our alums, Greg Strezik, up here in front, come and give a talk on using data analytics in sports as a career. His title was From Moneyball to Victory Lane, an overview of the sports analytics field, to a packed room of both students and faculty who came. Greg has found success in NASCAR, using his data analytics skills to bring home a NASCAR championship. And he even has the ring to prove it, which, did you remember to wear that today? He's got it, okay. So SSI has also been able to sponsor the work of our affiliated faculty in the research area. Professor Kraft, where's Nicole at? I've seen her earlier today. Okay, she's probably getting a donut.
She's bringing in a panelist,
okay. She has received a grant money to be able to fund,
there she is.
Work on our college athletes using iPads and with a split sample about trying to maximize the use of that technology for our athletes in the classroom. Professor Chris Noster is working on funding a national sports survey and a longitudinal survey that will provide hopefully unparalleled data on issues that face society in sports. And that survey is happening with our Center for Human Resources Research, which, if you don't know about that center here on campus, has for 50 years conducted the National Longitudinal Survey on work and life balance for the United States government. So it's a very impressive entity. We're also proud of the many students we have here. We have a number of journalism students reporting for the Lantern. I'd also like to ask if Walt King is here yet. Great. Walt is one of our students who works very closely with Trevon. We have a number of students involved with our faculty research. Walt recently presented at the MIT Sloan Conference on his measure of baseball analytics and is going to be working in that field when he leaves here at Ohio State. We also hope to offer a summer institute in the future where we can introduce younger students who are passionate about athletics to career options outside of work as a professional athlete. The world of sports needs more data analytics, sound engineers, writers, radio and TV announcers, nutritionists, medical professionals in all areas to treat sports-related injuries, just to name a few. Ohio State should be teaching them about these options, listening to their ideas, and helping shape the future of our young people. We'd also ask you to try to follow us on Twitter. It's at Sports and Society. When we started this, we had a very lame 20 followers for a very long time. I'm happy to say our comm students who are interns with Sports and Society have done a great job of getting that number up. And thanks to Nicole, she also suggested the hashtag of AthletePayOSU for us today. Thank you again for your support of our efforts here. And without further ado, join me in welcoming Professor Trevon Logan, who will introduce our first panel.
Thanks, Jan. And this idea does come directly from Professor Dunn, who wants to marry two things, which are academics who have a desire to generate more light than heat, and also not to be boring. So we decided to bring on experts who would have a nice, intellectually stimulating, but not overly academic conversation about this very controversial issue. And I'm excited to introduce this panel of experts. We have joining us today Vince Doria, who is the former ESPN Senior Vice President and Director of News, Matt Mitten, who is a Professor of Law and Director of the National Sports Law Institute at the Marquette University Law School, Joe Nocera, who is the sports business columnist for the New York Times, and Andrew Zimbalist, who is the Robert A. Woods Professor of Economics at Smith College and a preeminent expert in the economics of sports. Our moderator, and who I will turn it over to now, is Professor Lucia Dunn, who is a professor of economics and the co-director of the Sports and Society Initiative here at OSU. Professor Dunn?
Thank you. Unfortunately, the NCAA could not send a representative today, but they did send a statement of their position, and I'd like to read, and this is from their bylaws, I'd like to read part of that right now. I quote, the NCAA is committed to a model of college sports based on amateurism, where the education is the first priority and sports come second. So this is their position, and it implies that student athletes cannot receive any pay beyond their college scholarship and now a small sum to cover the full cost of attendance. However, in the last few years, that NCAA amateurism model has come under fire, especially with some recent court cases where it's been charged that the NCAA acts as a cartel and violates U.S. antitrust laws. So that's the background to why we have brought these panels together today. We want to hear about this issue. And our first panel, each panel member is going to take between 10 and 15 minutes to lay out a position. And I think we will have some diverse positions here. And then after that, we're going to have a response and rebuttal period. So I will now call on our first panelist, Mr. Vince Doria.
Thank you, Lucia. You know, I should start, I guess, with a bit of full disclosure here. I worked for ESPN for 23 years. In that time, the network became the largest rights holder of college football games, aired a much higher volume of college basketball games than any other network. So ESPN had a lot to do with generating the revenue that has turned these two sports into a large entertainment industry. On their part, ESPN, through advertising revenue, subscription revenue, made a lot of money on this investment, which in turn helped pay my salary. So I have had a vested interest in the success of these two sports. You know, I should also note that Both Joe and Andrew have studied this topic closely for years now. They've written extensively about it. They're clearly better versed than I am in this area. And Matthews is one of the foremost experts in sports law in the country, and he has, without a doubt, the strongest grasp on the legal problems involved with paying college athletes. That said, I do have some thoughts on it, and I'll be happy to share them with you. You know, college athletes in its early incarnation was rooted in some high ideals, the purity of amateurism, the value of sportsmanship and teamwork, the goal of developing and maintaining a strong and healthy body. And those ideals probably still exist today in most college programs, but they've certainly been overshadowed by the fact that football and basketball have evolved into this large entertainment industry with a business model that generates billions of dollars and a workforce that is essentially unpaid. It's a business model that any company would embrace, I think. Now, the justification for this arrangement has been that the participants, while not legally classified as employees, receive fair compensation in the form of a college education that's worth, you know, somewhere between $200,000 and $300,000 over a four-year period, depending upon the institution. And the education, of course, could form the basis, potentially, of a lifetime career in a profession or industry. Beginning in 2015, this compensation has been increased with a stipend that is anywhere generally from $1,500 to $6,000 a year per athlete, and they are granted this to help cover the so-called full cost of attendance. You know, I've always felt that the notion of providing a college education as fair compensation is an extremely misleading characterization of what is provided. A college scholarship typically provides a seat in a classroom or a lecture hall. It provides access to presentations by instructors and professors prepared for all students, access to books and materials, a dorm room, and meals. Now, those are all expenses, but in and of themselves, they don't constitute an education. Most of the responsibility for achieving an education falls on the student. Requires a considerable amount of hard work, time, and intellectual effort. And with that, without that on the part of the student, the scholarship isn't worth much. Nobody is given an education. A scholarship is really an opportunity to achieve an education. History tells us that in many cases, I think, certainly not all, athletes, you know, because of training, practices, games, travel, have less time than many students, and in some cases, not all certainly, but in some cases, arrive on campuses intellectually unprepared to do the work. In many programs, they have tutors supplied by the athletic department, but history tells us that the tutor's primary responsibility is to keep athletes eligible. That doesn't necessarily translate into an education. So if you buy my logic here, it's hard to square the revenue produced at many of the large programs. At Ohio State in 2013-14, it was $145.2 million, with what's provided to the workforce. Even if you want to count the money for scholarships as real dollars, which they are not, Ohio State spent $16.8 million on scholarships. That's roughly 11% of total revenue for the people who essentially create the product. Now, typically in labor-intensive businesses, and I would submit that college athletics is a labor-intensive business as to a business that is, say, highly automated, employers pay somewhere in the area of 20 to 40% of their revenue to their labor force and salary, some cases as high as 60%. As noted earlier, this is a great business model. Now, Andrew, I know, will tell you that only a handful of athletic programs show a significant operating profit, and he is correct in that assertion. But most programs have found a way to pay very high salaries to large coaching staffs and significantly upgrade facilities and stadiums. You know, there were two interesting stories that came out just this week from Clemson, and the juxtaposition of these stories, I think, is instructive. Dabo Sweeney, the football coach at Clemson, had a contract running for the next 6 years that was going to pay him roughly $3.4 million a year. Clemson tore that contract up. They weren't obligated to do so, but gave him a new contract that would pay him over $30 million for those 6 years, a little over $5 million a year. That's an increase for Dabo Sweeney of $1.6, $1.7 million. About 24 hours of that announcement, the Clemson Athletic Department announced that they were submitting a proposal to charge students for seats in the lower bowl at college games, seats that were previously free to the students. And coincidentally, if approved, and it's expected it will, it's expected that that will generate $1.8 million a year in revenue, which will nicely cover Dabo Swinney's increase. My point being here is athletic departments are very good at raising money when they want to, and they generally find ways to do it. You know, it hardly seems fair, does it, to the labor force that's creating this product to get such a little piece of the pie. The solutions aren't easy, of course. I mean, simply adopting a professional sports model seems difficult. Would there be a draft forcing students to attend schools that are geographically, culturally, and or academically unsuited for them? Would there be bidding wars? Would schools be forced to negotiate with, you know, unproven athletes who are going to come to their school, sometimes in basketball for 1 year and football for three, four at the most? It seems it would be a chaotic situation. There have been attempts to unionize college athletes, and the argument that they are not employees certainly would be undercut by any sort of professional model. There's not been a lot of public discussion about how compensation might work, because most of the debate has focused on simply whether or not athletes should be paid. But if compensation were to be deployed here, what sort of form would it take? Now, Joe wrote a very detailed piece in the Times back in January, and I'd endorse most of what he wrote there. It's based essentially on a salary cap model similar to what professional sports has. But his proposal is a significant leap forward, and given the resistance and the plodding nature of the NCAA, it's tough to believe there will be that kind of advancement in one fell swoop. I think if there's going to be advancement in this area, it's going to be incremental. The stipend was a first very small step. There's an idea here, and it's a very simple one, that could be the next step, and I'm going to refer to it as the tier model. And I'll use a football example, but obviously it could apply to basketball just as easily. And understand, this just might be a starting point. The numbers might be much different, but it serves as a basis for discussion. So let's say there were four levels of payment on a college football team, tiers 1, 2, 3, and 4. Tier 1 would be the highest. Prior to the season, an official depth chart would be classified. The first team would be tier 1 players, second team tier 2, third team tier 3, everybody else would be tier 4. And let's say tier 1 players would be paid $30,000 annually, tier 2, $20,000, tier 3, $10,000, tier 4, $5,000. During the course of the season, some players would move from first team to second team, players would move up when others were injured, players on second teams would play more in various situations and so forth. There would be a process to account for this at the end of the season. It might take a week to accomplish, not long. There would be a salary board established. It would likely be comprised of faculty, administrators, possibly students. I'd keep coaches out of it. Players would be able to come forward and make their case for additional compensation. So a defensive tackle might come forward on the second team and say, you know, I played 40% of the snaps, player X was injured, there were situations where I was used regularly. The board might look at that and decide to pay him $24,000, maybe more depending on how much 40% of the snaps represented compared to first team tackles. There's a way of adjusting salaries there incrementally. Now, as to the debate of whether or not this makes the players employees, well, if the current $6,000 figure has been determined to be a stipend because it covers full cost of attendance, let's come up with some suitable label that gets around legal difficulties if that's what is going to be the problem here. So at these figures, what would this cost an athletic department? Let's say the average salary for a player is $20,000 here. That's probably a little high given the number who'd be making $5,000, but let's err on the heavy side here. So a 100-player roster, the cost is going to be $2 million a year. It's not a lot compared to the $145.2 million that Ohio State took in. It's a little over 1%. And even if you want to add the $16.8 million scholarship cost, which are not real dollars, but let's assume they are, it still only puts labor costs at the 13% range, significantly less than most companies would employ. Now, Maybe these aren't the right figures, and they're likely low for fair compensation, and they certainly aren't fair for the Heisman Trophy candidate quarterback or the All-American running back or linebacker. But something like this, I think, begins to address the unfairness in the present system. And I realize not all schools generate the revenue Ohio State does. But all the Power Five schools share in college football playoff revenue, they share in gate receipts, they have lucrative regular season deals with networks, some including the Big Ten revenue from league-owned networks. At the rate listed here, I believe the money is available. And just make one clarifying point on this. The current stipends go to all student athletes given full cost of attendance label. That's only fair. But the stipends I'm discussing are based on the fact that these are revenue-producing sports. We're limiting this to football, men's basketball, and likely women's basketball, essentially sports with, you know, national television contracts. I understand that other sports get some television coverage. As part of its deal, ESPN agrees to televise a number of college sports, but we should understand that those sports are simply riding the coattails of football and basketball. They're getting exposure, but the viewing numbers are low, and they aren't generating revenue for either the networks or the university. Likely there might be some Title IX issues, certainly, that would have to be addressed. As noted, the solutions aren't easy. Now, is this the best solution? I don't know that. Others may have better ones. Joe's is certainly more detailed and addresses a number of related issues. I'm sure he'll talk about it. But these are the sort of solutions college athletics need to begin discussing and considering. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Vince. And now we will call on Matt Mitten, who will give us some insights from the legal perspective.
Well, thanks, Professor Dunn. I'm a proud Ohio State graduate. I'm really glad to see that the Sports and Society Initiative has come out of not only the College of Arts and Sciences, but Department of Economics. I was an economics major, and I sure wish we didn't have sports economics back in those days. Would have loved to have taken it, so it's a pleasure to be back here. Well, our topic is paying college athletes, and in my mind, the question is you know, really, who should decide if they're going to get paid, and if so, how much? As Vince mentioned, you know, there is certainly, you know, unfairness in the present system. So I'll have a proposal, but bear with me while I kind of, you know, go through this once. There's basically been traditionally two different models of U.S. domestic sports competition. One, the NCAA is based off of, it's called the amateur education model, which is traditionally described high school and college sports, where those playing the sports are student athletes. We're unique in the United States because of the close connection between athletics and educational systems at these levels, where students play sports for the love of the game and because of the life lessons. That's why high schools and colleges have traditionally offered it. And it's interesting, at both levels, high school and college, it was the students themselves that started playing sports. Then you had faculty and administrators saying, well, perhaps we should regulate it. Schools started playing schools, and then regulatory bodies developed. And the NCAA, I think it's very important to talk about, well, who is the NCAA? The NCAA is its member schools, more than 1,000 that play at three different divisions. They make the rules. And what the NCAA has, what they do, it's really two different roles. One is a vast self-regulation. You have this massive entity in Indianapolis with a whole host of people involved. So there's rules, enforcement, all of that. And they also put on championships in every sport except Division I FBS football. That is not something that the NCAA conducts. And the bulk of the revenues that come in are from the broadcast rights to the men's basketball tournament. So the NCAA rules say, well, these are amateurs, intercollegiate athletics, integral part of the educational program, and want to maintain this clear demarcation between intercollegiate and professional sports. The other model is the professional model, which I would call a commercial professional model, for-profit entities, part of the broader entertainment system, paid professional athletes. The two laws that have historically regulated that have been antitrust, which would promote a free market, but if the players would choose to unionize, they have, because for the majority of them, they're better off, and then we have collectively bargained terms and conditions of employment. Now, what has happened is that this traditional amateur education model has morphed into a commercial education model for
the college sports of football and men's basketball. Why is that? It's really because of how popular they are. They are, for the most part, the only two sports that consistently generate more revenues than costs. And what we're seeing is various efforts to try to professionalize college sports. But I think there's some important things to keep in mind, two important differences, at least, between college and professional sports. There's not any cash payments made to college athletes, unlike professional athletes, although there is now the stipends to an extent. There is no profit distribution. You don't have that. And the other thing that's unique about college sports is there's very much a cross-subsidization of most of the women's sports and the men's non-revenue sports. So those are some key differences to keep in mind here. So let's briefly go through, well, why aren't or are college athletes employees? Because there's no question they are one of the two primary inputs necessary to provide college sports, along with the coaches, who are, of course, incredibly well paid. It's very much a free market system of competition. So from a historical perspective, the judicial system has said, well, athletic scholarships are contracts. No question, there's various quid pro quos. You get an opportunity to get an education. And courts, for the most part, have said we're only going to enforce express promises between the university and its student athletes. And of course, NCAA and conference rules get incorporated into that. The first efforts to characterize college athletes as employees was when student athletes would suffer serious injuries while playing a sport and would attempt to recover workers' compensation benefits. And courts have pretty much uniformly said, well, they are not employees. Why not? Because this is not a contract for hire. And courts looked at it and they were focusing on, well, what did the parties really intend? It was that, well, they were full-time students. NCAA rules get incorporated. They are, quote, amateurs. There was some effort to make it, but they looked at the conduct and, you know, maybe the economic realities are, given the extensive degree of control that is exercised over student athletes, it's not only when they're playing and practicing, but it's like you take your courses at certain times, what courses you take, all of that. You could make an argument that, well, it's looking a little bit more like a traditional employment relationship than just the traditional student relationship. But nonetheless, courts were saying, no, not for workers' comp purposes. And then there was a very important antitrust case brought against the NCAA in 1984, challenging the exclusive college football television plan. And although it had nothing to do with whether college sports and athletes are amateur in nature, the Supreme Court said, quote, college athletes must not be paid. And what happened is the various challenges that were brought to NCAA eligibility rules, courts picked up on that, and basically it was per se illegal, any kind of eligibility rule out there, whether it's academic rules, rules that says you can't be paid more than the value of a full scholarship. And as one court said, the NCAA does not exist as a minor league training ground for future NFL players, but rather to provide an opportunity for competition among amateur students pursuing a collegiate education. So regardless of the realities, that was the view courts were taking. So let's shift now to what has happened. What have been these legal efforts, efforts to use the legal system to establish a commercial professional model for college sports, at least football and men's basketball. The antitrust cases came first, but I'm going to talk about the efforts by Northwestern football players to unionize. And I kept up with that very much because even though I teach at Marquette in Milwaukee, I live in downtown Chicago, so extensive coverage there. And it was interesting that that was chosen as the place, you know, to unionize. I mean, Northwestern, very high graduation rate, relatively few of their football players go on and play in the NFL. But it was a good example of forum shopping. Council knew that if you were going to find a regional director likely to characterize college football players as employees, it was going to be in Chicago. And that's, in fact, what happened. In a very detailed opinion, the Chicago regional director said, well, college athletes look a lot they're basically employees. If you look at the degree of control, scholarship is compensation, all of that taken together. So essentially applying much the same factors that courts did in determining that college athletes were not employees reached the exact opposite conclusion. However, to a lot of people's surprise, including mine, the five-member National Labor Relations Board in Washington, so Northwestern appealed that, and the NLRB basically said, well, maybe they are employees, but we're not going to exercise jurisdiction. The NLRB has that discretion, and they looked at it and they said, well, Northwestern is the only private school in the Big Ten of the 14 schools, and I think there's only maybe 20 private schools among the 130 or so Division I FBS schools. And under federal labor law, it is only employees at private schools, or, you know, private industry. The National Labor Relations Act only regulates private employment relationships. So you could not, for example, if you're a public school football player, like at Ohio State, you could only unionize if state law permitted it. And Ohio moved very, very quickly to pass a law that said no college athlete in Ohio could do it. So you can't have a system like in the NFL or the NBA or Major League Baseball where all the athletes can unionize and collectively bargain. Not possible under current law. Another interesting case along this line was an effort by University of Pennsylvania track and field athletes to collect workers' compensation, or not workers' compensation. They were trying to get minimum wage. They made the claim unsuccessfully that they were employees under the Fair Labor Standards Act. And this is an interesting one because Penn is part of the Ivy League where athletic scholarships, they have agreed not to provide them. And there the court relying on much the same reasoning of courts finding that there was athletes are not employees for workers' comp benefits said, no, you're not entitled to workers, to minimum wage. Which brings us to the O'Bannon case, which has been going on for a number of years, will likely reach the U.S. Supreme Court. In the interest of time, I won't go through the district court's decision, but it goes up on appeal. And here's what the current law is. Now, one of the most significant things is that this was the first federal appellate court that said that NCAA eligibility rules are a commercial restraint that can be challenged under federal antitrust law. Almost all the other ones said, no, those are a form of non-commercial internal regulation, not subject to antitrust challenge, presumed to be legal. So that was a significant victory for the plaintiffs and the student athletes in that case. The Ninth Circuit affirmed the lower court's decision, which says that there are some pro-competitive justifications for these rules, which is a form of price fixing, no question, when the NCAA schools get together and cap the amount of compensation that any student athlete can get. The real question is, well, are there any countervailing pro-competitive justifications? Because the rule is we balance the positives and the negatives. And two of them were basically found, that the limits on compensation integrate academics with athletics and preserve the popularity of college sports by promoting amateurism. And the key part of the Ninth Circuit's decision is they said that providing the full cost of attendance, that would be a substantially less restrictive means of achieving those objectives. So for example, maintaining the amateur nature of college sports can still exist, but you bump up that amount, whereas there had been that 1,500, 2,500 or so disparity in the past. However, the court then went on to say, you can't pay student athletes more than that. As the district court had said, well, an amount up to a $5,000 per student athlete per year they play, I don't think that that would be something that would change the fundamental brand of college sports, which is fairly extraordinary for a judge. I mean, judges are not regulators. And for a federal judge to say, well, I find unreasonable price fixing, the solution is what I think is reasonable price fixing. So not surprising to those who are knowledgeable about antitrust law that that would be reversed. And the Ninth Circuit said, well, what not paying student athletes is precisely what makes them amateurs, and made it pretty clear that any cash stipends offered had to be tethered to educational expenses. So that's where we're at this point. The case is on appeal to the U.S. Supreme Court. I think it's fairly likely the Supreme Court will hear it because of its importance. Then there's a couple other cases going on that are trying to use antitrust law to take even more drastic steps, which we'll maybe talk about in discussion. So I've only got a couple more minutes, so I'll go through this really quickly. My view is that professionalization of college sports is not the answer to the current problems caused by commercialized college sports. What are those problems? I think there's really at least three important things. One, there's a misallocation of resources from academics to athletics. Universities, at most schools, or at most universities, they put more into their athletic program than they get out of it in economic terms. So there are resources going from the academic side, or could be used for the academic side, over to the athletic side. Why do they do it? Well, it's a rational investment. You know, sports is, particularly winning high-profile teams, it's the front porch of the university. It is not an unrational decision to make. But two of the more significant problems that also arise is the marginalization of the educational aspects of college sports, particularly for athletes of color playing big-time sports. The lowest graduation rates are for men's football and, of course, football and men's basketball. That's a problem if the athletes who play those sports are, you know, giving their playing services and not getting the benefit of the bargain, which is the degree. The other thing is economic exploitation of elite Division I football and men's basketball players. Quite honestly, there's probably only a handful of athletes whose fair market value exceeds the marginal revenue product of what the value of their athletic scholarship is. So the real question here is, how do we solve the problems but preserve the social benefits of the commercial education model of college sports? What does it do beneficially? Provides access to college educational opportunities for the athletically gifted. It's a popular, distinctive brand of entertainment. This cross-subsidization of sports, which is rampant in universities. I know as a law professor, for years, law schools have cross-subsidized many other departments of the university. It happens. I mean, there is a shifting of resources. That, I think, is a very good thing because it increases output. We have more opportunities for women, for female athletes, for male non-revenue sports. And I think that the social and public policy benefits in the long term are going to be much better coming up with something other than professionalizing college sports. What's not going to work? So I'll just go through this real quickly here. Certainly, you can't have unionization of college sports. Even if antitrust law, you know, were applied, antitrust law is prohibitory in nature. It says these are unreasonable restraints. It doesn't say what you have to do. So antitrust is not a good regulatory model. If you apply it to pro sports, professional athletes have chosen to unionize because collectively they can be better off by unionizing. Economically self-interested NCAA internal reform doesn't work. It's just asking too much of of the universities to do this. So I will talk about later during the thing is it's a proposed federal regulatory model where it's open and transparent. Everyone will have a full and equal voice, and then there'll be antitrust immunity if their reforms would be voluntarily adopted. So thank you.
Thank you, Matt. Okay, our next speaker is Joe Nocera.
I don't have any written notes. So bear with me. So Matt just said that the Second Circuit said that the compensation has to be tethered to education. So let's talk about how Alabama does that. Prior to the passage of the new stipend that gives athletes the full cost of attendance. Stipends, by the way, that came about because the Power Five conferences basically threatened to leave the NCAA, which is how they got the power to do that. the full cost of attendance at Alabama was somewhere around $2,500. And Nick Saban woke up one day and said, you know, over at Auburn, it's like $4,000. And we're going to have a recruiting disadvantage. And today, at Alabama, it's over $5,000. So the idea that they're not using money to recruit athletes is bullshit. So is the idea that the NCAA says in their statement to us that education is the first priority and athletics come second. Everybody knows that's insane. Everybody knows that's not true. If it was really true, you wouldn't send East Coast teams to Oregon to play in March Madness. You wouldn't have Hawaii leaving their campus from March 1 to March 19th to play sports. You wouldn't have players not allowed to take majors that they're interested in because it interferes with practice. You wouldn't have a system where the so-called 20-hour-a-week limit doesn't include watching film, doesn't include travel, doesn't include an entire weekend spent on a game except for the 3 hours of the game. They shouldn't call them student athletes, which, by the way, is a term of propaganda created in 1956 to avoid workers' compensation. Call them what they are. Call them athlete students, because that at least tells you what the priority is. Or call them employee students, because that's what they really are. Football players and men's basketball players have been brought to the university to generate revenue for the university. That's their job. Everything else is secondary. Some of them get to graduate, some of them get a good education, many of them don't. The fundamental role of an academic counselor is not to get the athlete an education, it's to keep the athlete on the floor or on the field. We need to acknowledge this. There is a fundamental disconnect between a multi-billion dollar entertainment complex and a university. Universities are ill-equipped to be running these multi-billion dollar complexes, which is why you have these disparities in education, in the abilities of students, athletes, or athletes to do things that other students can do, and all these kind of, all the various problems that we're talking about. Now, you know, there's a million things you can write about when you're at the New York Times. And for 5 years, I was on the op-ed page, and I really could write about anything that I wanted to. And I kind of fell into this. And people used to, when I first started writing about it for the Times, I would get occasional emails from angry readers who would say, why are you wasting your time on sports? You know, why don't you write something about something important like politics, like nobody at the New York Times writes about politics, right? And I said, this is not a sports issue. This is a human rights issue and it's a civil rights issue. Because it is overlaid with race, and I hope we get into that a little bit later. And so I came at this originally not through the prism of money or pay, but through the prism of rights. What first got me really angry was learning about a Connecticut freshman named Ryan Boatwright who was not able to play, who was ineligible to play because the NCAA was investigating his mother, who had the nerve, if you can believe this, to accept money, single mom, raising four kids, who accepted money so that she could go on recruiting trips to see where her son might play college basketball. This, of course, is a crime. And what made it worse was not just that this investigation going on, but the extent to which she was humiliated, harassed, locked in a hotel room for 5 hours with four white guys and not allowed to make a phone call. I mean, come on. This is not right. And as I learned more, I began to understand that college athletes simply don't have the rights of every other student on campus, and for that matter, every other American. They don't have rights of due process when they get in trouble with the NCAA. Neither do coaches, by the way. They're extremely limited in what they can take, what they can do. You know, any other student, if you're a fabulous music student, prized in the music department, and you want to transfer because your favorite teacher went to Stanford, nobody tells you have to sit out a year. Or you can only go to certain schools, but you can't go to any schools in the Big Ten. You can't go to Stanford because that's where your teacher went, so you're not allowed to do that. Why is that? Why is an athlete restricted like that? Why is that right? So among the rights that athletes are deprived of are economic rights. Every other student on campus has the right to make money. Some maybe make a lot of money because they're a fabulous musician, or they're starting a company out of their back pocket while they're at Stanford, or and some others make money in the cafeteria. They're students, and they make money, and there's no problem. But if we talk about an athlete making money, then of course a terrible thing is about to happen. College sports is about to be destroyed, and we have to protect the athletes from whatever. So let's be honest about what the NCAA is. It's a cartel. It is a cartel. It exists, the amateurism rules fundamentally exist to ensure that the labor force is paid, is unpaid, and that Nick Saban can make $7 million, and Mike Krzyzewski can make $10 million, and Jim Harbaugh can make $5 million. And OSU can afford to build a $40 million indoor practice facility for the football players. Now, why do they build these facilities? They build them so that they can press recruits who will come to the school. Wouldn't it be cheaper just to pay some of the money to the recruits instead? So, you know, Vince talked about the salary cap idea I had. Andy helped talk me out of that idea. On the sensible grounds that you need a party that represents the players in order to be able to do that, which is why you have salary caps in the pros, because you have unions. And also, by the way, which is why every time there's a union fight with a major league the union threatens to decertify, because if they decertify, there goes the salary cap. So I've moved away from the salary cap idea, although I do like the idea that a coach ought to be able to use money to recruit an athlete. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I went to Boston University because they gave me the biggest scholarship. I made a decision based on money. Tons of students go to schools based on money. Who has the lowest fees? How much does a state school cost versus a private school? Who gives the largest? And by the way, I think it would be a more honest system. If you said, I'll sign a 3-year contract, I'll pay you $40,000 a year, you're here till at least you're a junior. It's more honest. I've been advocating for a long time. Part of the problem here is that so much money is sloshing around under the table. Now all these sleazy agents, all these people getting paid to direct athletes to certain schools. You know, just say, come here and I'll pay you. And, you know, maybe I'll pay you less than the other school, but I'll give you more because I'm a better football place and you have a better chance to get into the pros. Even beyond that, athletes should have economic rights and they should be able to find their value like every other American. And, that doesn't mean they should make $1 million or $2 million. There are units, you know, the NCAA, in my view, violates the antitrust laws because they have 100% market power and there's no competition. There's no ability for anybody to offer any competition to the NCAA in terms of the way it compensates. But conferences, for instance, do have competition from other conferences. And so, for instance, the Ivy League actually has a different compensation model than everybody else. Nobody says it's wrong. Nobody says they can't do it. It just happens to be lower than the NCAA's compensation limit because they don't give athletic scholarships. But I don't see any reason why you couldn't have competition for athletes between the Big Ten, the ACC, the Big 12, all the other schools, all the other conferences. Now, you know, one of the implications of paying players is that, you know, you'd have a problem with the Middle Tennessees and all the schools that make March Madness so much fun because they win a couple of rounds before the big boys squash them. I think that's okay. As I said before, you know, we have this giant entertainment, multi-billion dollar entertainment complex attached to universities. That's never going to change on some level because it's so popular, so many people want it, and because Matt is right, schools are not irrational when they pour money into football and basketball and other sports because it is a front porch. I mean, at this school, so how many people are in this room? 150, 200 people? 69,000 people, as I understand it, have paid $5 to see the spring game at OSU, which is going to take place shortly. $5 a pop, 69,000. You know, that's the way the world works. This stuff is not going away. However, it does seem to me that beyond the major powers, 70, 80 football teams, 130 to 160 or 70 basketball teams, we would be well served as a country if other schools who couldn't afford this, who make a different decision about compensation, and who basically say, okay, we can't play in that league. We're going to think about athletics different on this campus. We're going to maybe downplay athletics a little bit and emphasize education a little bit more and think about the way we run our university a little differently. I'm okay with that. We have a system that is so completely commercialized now. The Final Four, the pregame of the Final Four, it looked like the Super Bowl. It did. With the players' faces on the floor and the lights shining and all the hoopla and the Capital One this and the, you know, it is absurd to say that this is not a complete 100% commercial enterprise except in one area, which is the labor force, which is free. I think that's wrong. I think it needs to change. But I also think that the chances for change are extremely slim, partly because of the courts, and partly because there is an entire enormous infrastructure allied on the other side whose economic self-interest hinges on not paying the players. And so they can talk all they want about amateurism and education and all the rest of it and all the other paternalistic reasons they have for not paying players. But the bottom line is the money that should be going to the players is making everybody else rich. I'll stop there.
Okay. Thank you, Joe. And now I'll call on Professor Zimbalist.
So the last time that I competed with Joe was about 15 years ago. We used to have a Tuesday afternoon tennis match all the time. And it's nice to, given my advanced age, it's nice not to be doing that and instead to have some verbal confrontation. Look, you know, and by the way, a lot's been said, so I'll cut my remarks shorter. I agree fundamentally with everything that Matt Mitten said. You know, I think all of us on the panel acknowledge that there's hypocrisy in college sports, there's economic exploitation in college sports, there's injustice in college sports. The question is, how do you fix it, or how do you make it a little bit better? And there are two basic choices you can make. You can say, okay, we'll give in, it's already commercialized, let's create a full-blown market system for those schools that want to do that. And another way you can go is to say, let's see if we can make the educational model work and hold the NCAA to the fire around some of the things that it says it's all about. Can we reform the system in that way? Let me go from there to make a few comments about why I think it's extremely problematic to move towards the pay-for-play model. One of them is you have to answer the question where the money is going to come from. The last NCAA report, the revenues and expenses report, in FBS has the median deficit of athletic programs at $14.7 million. That's on an operating basis. That's before you count most capital expenses and some other indirect expenses. The NCAA has another report out that says the typical FBS school has the equivalent of $25 million a year in capital expenses. So you're talking about deficits run out of athletic programs that are above $20 and $30 million a year. Now, it might be true, as Vince, I thought Vince did a very nice job presenting some possible alternatives, but in his alternative, he says the wage costs are going to be about $2 million a year. Now, it might be true that Ohio State can easily afford that. It might be true that Wisconsin and Michigan can. But the median revenue in football in the FBS, the top 128 football schools, is $21 million. It's not $100 million plus, which a lot of the Big Ten schools have. Moreover, if you start paying college athletes, you then have to deal with workman's compensation, unemployment compensation, payroll taxes that are paid both by the school and by the athlete, income taxes paid by the athlete, the possible loss of a myriad of tax preferences that college sports today presently benefits from. So you all know about this. The boosters put down $10,000 and they get the right to buy seats on the 50-yard line or the 40-yard line, and they get to deduct 80% of that from their federal income taxes. UBIT taxation, unrelated business income taxation. There's a fragmentation principle there which would allow the IRS to tax signage revenue at Ohio Stadium and other forms of revenue. They decide not to do that. College football teams and basketball teams get to issue tax-exempt bonds. All of these things are up for reevaluation if you move to a pay-for-play model. There's a lot there. It's not just the two million dollars that you're going to pay in Vince's model. There are a lot of other costs that are going to fall both on the athlete and on the university. I also agree with Matt wholeheartedly when he says the truth is that there's a handful of athletes on a typical FBS football team or basketball team that are the real stars, who are the ones who are being economically exploited in the most significant way by getting a scholarship that's worth $50,000 or $60,000 a year. Because those are the ones, there aren't very many of them, but those are the ones who are going to go to the pros, and they're going to start getting in basketball an average salary of $5.5 million a year, in football $3 million a year. And they're getting a scholarship worth $60,000. At the college level, if professional athletes are compensated at 50% of the league's revenue, at the college level, these people, instead of getting, these athletes, instead of getting, if it were a market system, instead of getting $6 million in the NFL, they would be getting $2 or $3 million in the NCAA. So they are exploited economically. They're the ones who I worry about in terms of economic exploitation, except they don't worry that much, because they're the same ones, and Maurice Claret is an exception to this, there are exceptions to this, but they're the same ones who are going to go on and play in the pros in another year or two and make the $6 million a year. So I don't think that the going to a pay-for-play model solves many economic problems at all. I think it's also important to look a little bit at the economic landscape of college sports. One of the reasons why college sports has grown economically so much in the last 15 or 20 years is because there's been a sustained and pronounced boom in television revenue. I think that's over. There are many, many changes that are going on in telecommunications technology today that I think are undermining the value of sports rights, and we see it all over the place. I don't have a lot of time to talk about it now, but I'd be happy to talk about it in discussion. But briefly, we have the phenomenon of cord cutting, phenomenon of cord shaving, the phenomenon of cord nevers. People are not subscribing to expanded basic cable packages the way they used to, which is why that Vincent's ESPN is cutting back staff, which is why that Fox Sports is cutting back staff, which is why Steve Ballmer, who paid $2 billion for the Clippers thinking he was going to get a Lakers television contract, hasn't been able to find that contract, which is why the Dodgers can't get their games on television in LA and the Yankees can't get their games on Comcast in New York. It's hitting the wall. And although there's a Big Ten network that's been very successful, I don't think you're going to see growing revenue, and I think in the future you're going to see shrinking revenue. So not only do you have this problem with deficits, large deficits, but I think they're going to get worse. And part of the problem there, by the way, is institutional. Part of the problem is that these programs that are so heavily commercialized don't have stockholders like normal corporations do. You don't have stockholders who say, we want to see a profit at the end of the quarter so the price of the stock goes up. What you have instead in college sports are shareholders or stakeholders whose goal is not to have a profit, whose goal is to have a team that wins. And that's the message that the athletic director gets. So the athletic director, if more revenue comes in, the athletic director finds a way to build a $40 million indoor football stadium, finds a way to have new training centers, and finds a way to spend more on recruiting. So it's almost impossible, given the institutional structure within which college sports operates, to generate surpluses in the athletics programs. So I think it makes more sense, if we're concerned about athlete well-being, it makes more sense to talk about reforms along these lines. Schools should provide medical care and pay for the medical care for college athletes that has long-term coverage for disabilities that are suffered when they're in school. That schools should pay for insurance that gives athletes who have disabilities suffered from playing college athletics, covers them for income replacement for what they would have been able to earn if they had been able to go to the pros and had not been disabled. I think we can have reforms that provide athletes with due process. That doesn't have to stay the same the way it's been in the NCAA. We can have rules that say, let's redefine what it means to be an amateur. An amateur is something, the definition that the NCAA has used for amateurism has morphed over the years. It morphs at their convenience. But I think that most of us understand an amateur to mean somebody who doesn't get paid for playing an activity. So fine, for me, that's fine. I'm willing to go with that activity, that definition of amateurism. But what that means is that there's no reason for the NCAA to tell a student athlete that he or she can't have an agent to talk about the possible benefits of going pro or the strategy for going pro. It means that the NCAA can't say to the student, if you enter a professional draft, you can't come back, you lose your eligibility. It should mean that they can't impose the restrictions that they do on transfer payments. And it should mean that athletes should be able to go out and get endorsement income or licensing income from activity outside of playing on the field or the basketball court. So I think there are meaningful reforms that can address some of the economic injustices that we have without going to an open system of pay-for-play. The people who are endorsing the pay-for-play model, as Joe has done and as Vince has done, I think quite rightly, other than saying I'm in favor of it, it's very hard to know where to go. Joe has backed off of his salary cap idea. You can't do that without collective bargaining. There's no non-statutory labor exemption to allow you to do that. And Vince wants to go to a tier model. Intellectually, there's nothing wrong with that idea. How are you going to do it? Who's going to decide that that's what you're doing? Who gets to decide that? Is it the NCAA? Is it a bunch of college commissioners? Is it President Obama? Is it students associations who decide that? It's very hard to know what system should emerge. And at the end of the day, you're still exploiting the stars. The star athletes, the star quarterbacks, and the star centers who are producing millions of dollars in value for your team, you're going to give them $40,000 and say you've got a good system? And then your second string linebacker is going to get $10,000 or $20,000 above the COA, which is well above what that person's marginal revenue product is. That solves a problem? I don't think so. So there's some real issues. Other than saying pay for play sounds nice and it deals with exploitation, there's some real issues about how do you get there, what do you do? And frankly, I think that Matt's model, although he didn't fully lay it out, makes as much sense as any. Let me just end with one comment about branding. This debate almost always includes a discussion about, well, what happens to the brand of college sports if we do away with amateurism, if we pay the athletes? And there'll be one side that vociferously claims it's going to undermine, and this is what the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals basically said, if we pay the athletes more than the COA, then it's going to undermine the brand. People aren't going to be interested in it anymore. It's going to be like minor league baseball. So some people will be interested in it, but it won't have the commercial value that it currently has. And then there are other people who say, that's nonsense. We professionalized the Olympics, and people still like the Olympics. We professionalized the golf and tennis way back in the 60s, and people still follow those sports. So why can't we do that with college sports? There's actually an interesting and involved discussion we can have about that, but I just want to posit to you that we don't know what's going to happen to the brand. I don't know if one side is right or the other, and I think probably whatever damage might or might not happen to the brand will have a lot to do with what system we end up with and how we transition from where we are to that new system. Thank you.
Okay. A lot of interesting thoughts here. And now we're going to have a period of response and rebuttal amongst our panelists. Now, the audience will have a chance for Q&A, but after the second panel, we're going to save all the audience questions for then. So who wants to go first? Who would like to respond to respond to something that's been said?
Well, let me respond to, Andrew makes a very good case for his argument, but let me respond to the television rights issue that Andrew brought up, which has been around for a long time. Every time a new television deal has been signed, the naysayers say, this is it, the golden goose is about to, turn to rock here or something. The money's going to change. A couple examples, though, just in the past couple of weeks suggest certain things. Andrew's right about the cable television model. It's under fire right now. Cord cutting has reduced subscriptions for most cable services, but the content is still being produced, and it's still going to appear on platforms somewhere, and somebody's going to pay for the right to do it. National Football League just sold their Thursday night package, by the way, to two networks now, NBC and CBS, instead of one, who are willing to pay the NFL a lot of money to basically simulcast games that are also being aired on the NFL network, a free ride for the NFL. But most instructive, they sold their live streaming rights to Twitter. Now, that's a platform that didn't pay rights for anything before, okay? That's new revenue for the National Football League. The NCAA just extended their CBS and Turner deal for 8 years through 2032. Previous deal was $8.8 billion over 8 years' time. Works out to about $920 million a year or something. I think you're right. Okay. The new deal, is $10.8 billion for 14 years. Works out to about $1.1 billion. So they're paying more now per year over the next 8 years, well, starting in 24 to 32, than they were paying previously. So these rights have gone up, all right? Now, certainly there's concern that at some point the bloom is gonna come off the roads here on rights deals, but it never seems to happen. New players are getting involved. Sports is one of the few live television entities out there, and whether that's live cable television or live streaming on the internet, on your mobile device or whatever, it's an exclusive product. There's only so much of it, and I believe there are always going to be entities willing to pay to put it on their platform. I don't have a crystal ball. We don't know if that's going to happen, but every time rights come up, the entity selling those rights, whether it's the National Football League, NCAA, or whatever, seems to be making more money on it.
Do I get
yes,
rebuttal?
Yes, sure. Sure, just raise your
like
hands.
Bernie Sanders.
it looks like Bernie Sanders. That's
all right, now I'm angry. first of all, the NCAA deal, let's talk about that. They're on a deal now, it started in 2011, it goes through 2024, that's $771 million per year average. They signed a deal last week for $1.1 billion a year average between 2025 and 2034. If you put that into a present value and you use a very conservative discount rate of 5%, that turns out to be, in present value, it turns out to be worth about $500 million. So you could look at that and say, aha, rights are going up. But in fact, what the NCAA has done with CBS and Turner is to sign a deal for payments way into the future that has a present value well below what their current present value is. So that is not an indication of growth in television rights. In terms of, they'll find a platform to put it on. Of course they'll find a platform to put it on. Everybody will find it, and sports is great. People will want to watch it. But what's happened between the 1980s and the last couple of years is that regional sports channels would charge, depending on the channel and depending on the part of the country, they charge $1, $2, $5, $6 to the cable distributor, which was usually a monopolist. The cable distributor would pass on the $6 in the cable bill in an expanded basic package with 190 channels. They put in $6, and they turn around and they pay ESPN or the YES Network $5 or $6 per month per subscriber to do that. Now, that's a tremendously beneficial package or institutional structure for the regional sports network and therefore for the teams and the leagues, because they get a much larger, they're getting to charge to watch their channel to everybody in the market instead of 10% of the market. So the subscription fees are much, much higher, and because the subscription fees are higher and there are more people who potentially are watching, the advertisers pay much, much more for spot on the show. So advertising income is higher, subscription income is higher, and that model is now is being diminished. It's going to diminish rapidly. It's not just cord cutting, it's cord shaving. So the telcos are in competition with DirecTV, which is in competition with the cable distributors, and they are starting to offer smaller, or Sling TV. They're offering smaller cable bundles and specialized cable bundles, so not everybody's going to have to buy ESPN or the YES Network going forward. Now, that is going to hurt. But yes, I agree with Vince, they'll find somewhere to do it. The question is, what kind of revenue are they going to generate? And I think it's going to be a lot less.
Well, then the question is, Andy, is the implication of what you're saying is that coaches will make less money and there'll be fewer practice facilities? I don't think so. You also said that, quote unquote, they'll find a way. They find a way, and that is what they do. They find a way. And so, do you think that if you're right, which I'm a little skeptical of, but if you're right,
oh, Joe, how's your backhand? Okay, sorry.
It's not bad actually. Does that mean that schools will start to cut back on what they pay big-time coaches? I think it's far more likely they'll cut the tennis team, if anything.
That might be the case. I mean, let's go back also to something that Vince observed. I think is very important if we're talking about paying football players and paying male and maybe female basketball players. We have a problem with Title IX, right? Title IX doesn't allow you to give differential scholarship amounts to men and women. If women are 43% of all athletes, they have to get between 42 and 44% of the scholarship money. I think all of the court cases that have been around scholarship payments to college athletes have upheld that principle. So if we're going to start paying, whether it's $30,000 or $40,000 per player, or whether we're going to have an open market and pay more than that, we're going to have to find some way, money also, I should have said this when I was talking about taxes, we have to find some money also to pay similar amounts to the women. So yeah, I'm not sure exactly what you're getting at when you say, will coaches' salaries go down or will.
Well, I'm responding.
One of the things about coaches' salaries I think is important to understand. Matt referred to it as a free market competition, but it's a rigged market. Here I sound like Bernie Sanders again. It's a rigged market. Why is it a rigged market? It's principally, number one, because we're not paying the producers, we're not paying the players. Number two, because it's a market where there aren't stockholders that are demanding to see profits at the end of the day. They're demanding to see their stakeholders, demanding to see wins. Number three, because it's the beneficiary of all of these tax preferences and subsidies from the school. So, yeah. It's a market, and those salaries are reflecting what the market forces are saying, but it's a totally artificial market.
Well, so is the market for CEOs, and so you can talk about it, shareholders, but that's a rigged market too, between boards of directors that are largely populated by CEOs, paying CEOs of one company, and in return, the CEO who sits on another board pays. I mean, it's at that level, yeah, sure, it's a rigged market. But I one of the things I don't understand, Andy, is why you would actually want to defend the tax deduction that boosters can get for buying a seat license. It's a business. It's a business. Some of this stuff should be taxed. The idea that this is all an educational enterprise and therefore you can take giant tax breaks so you can fill your stadium and make millions of dollars seems kind of obscene, actually.
Why do you think I'm defending that? I'm pointing out that if you change some of the current institutions, that some of the preferences that colleges now enjoy might be ended, and therefore the costs of making the transition are higher than, say, the model that Vince put out there.
Okay. Who wants to take up now?
Well, I will, you know, just to kind of pick up on a little bit what Andy was suggesting, and I'll just briefly go through, and this wasn't, this proposal is not just me alone, it was in conjunction with Professor Steve Ross, who's a law professor at Penn State University. So there'd be certain mandatory requirements. One would be, as Andy mentioned, you know, healthcare, medical insurance, all of that, there's no question that should be for all student athletes across the board. And it should be at least a four-year athletic scholarship, you know, not the historical one-year renewable at the coach's option. It's kind of once you come in, and that distinguishes it really from a professional model where they're, you know, even guaranteed contracts aren't really guaranteed for the most part. It's only if you make the team. So it should be if you come in, you're fortunate enough to get a scholarship, you've got it for 4 or 5 years, period, whether you get hurt, whether you're not quite as good as the coach thought you were. And I think the other requirement in here, and it's an important one, is the NCAA requires that all Division I schools offer at least 14 sports. And that's problematic. Under our proposal, that would go out the door, and then each Division I school could determine what is going to be its mix of sports. Of course, consistent with Title IX, gender equity, there would certainly be a realignment there. And that would also give each university the ability to be financially self-supporting. You know, that's one of the problems, because, I mean, as Andy mentioned, these huge subsidies and stuff, at some point, that has got to end. It's just getting really unwieldy. So what we're proposing is, it's not like, for example, a governmental entity that would regulate college sports. The U.S. is very different in that we do not have, unlike many European countries, a federal government sports minister. We do not have that. It's very much a free market system, self-regulated at each level up through youth, high school, college, professional. We wouldn't advocate that there be an entity like the Federal Trade Commission overseeing this. This would be an independent group appointed by the president, and then you would have anyone who wants to could make a proposal. It could be members of Congress or whomever. And then the commission would say, well, here's what we think ought to be reasonable rules. So, for example, a cap on coaches' salaries or whatever they come up with. And then it would be entirely up to the NCAA, conferences, member schools, if they choose to adopt it. And the question is, well, why would they? Well, the carrot would be antitrust immunity. That could not be challenged on antitrust grounds because, again, by adopting it, it would be an agreement among NCAA member schools that would be subject to Section 1. And then let's say the coaches or whomever are hurt by it, you would go to an independent arbitral tribunal to work it out. I think that would, and you could, all of these various proposals could come through it that way there. I think that's a pretty good system. It's not, the NCAA schools aren't going to be able to do it. It's way too much economic self-interest. That's proven not to work. Antitrust law is not going to work. The question is, how do we come up with it? But we don't want to throw out the baby with the bathwater, so to speak. There's a lot of benefits to college sports that we want to maintain.
Okay. Let me follow up with that. Matt, in your law review article discussing the Adidas case, you actually make the statement, I have it written down here, just like Wolf Blitzer. Another, in talking about the Adidas case, you call this another example of unwarranted judicial deference to NCAA regulation of economic competition amongst its members. Now, there's a lot of talk about how the courts are going to settle this and are going to handle a lot of things, but, you know, haven't we seen the courts have a tendency to look at this one way? I mean, what did you mean by that statement?
was the Adidas case? I don't think that was the...
It's from your Adidas Marquette Sports Law Review article.
Oh, Marquette Sports, that's a different one. Okay, I thought it was... The one that I was talking about comes from an Oregon Law Review article. Well, courts, you know, as I mentioned, have been very deferential in applying antitrust law to the NCAA. Mm-hmm. Antitrust by its nature is very, you know, what is an unreasonable restraint of trade? You balance the anti-competitive effects with the pro-competitive justifications, and then courts have engrafted this. Is there a substantially less restrictive means of achieving legitimate pro-competitive economic objectives? That all goes into the mix, and it's very, of course, complicated. So for years, courts just basically deferred to whatever the NCAA said was necessary to preserve college sports, whether it was competitive balance, maintaining college sports as a separate brand from professional sports. But I think starting with the O'Bannon case, we're starting to see a change, whereas now courts are saying, look, these, even though they're packaged as eligibility rules, these are commercial restraints, and therefore it's got to go through this traditional, what's known as the full rule of reason, where there is a balancing, which is very difficult to apply to sports at whatever level. It's just not easy at all. So that's, I think, what I meant, because that Marquette article is probably quite a few years old.
You know, actually, the courts have been pretty good about seeing through the NCAA's argument when it comes to adults. So Board of Regents, for instance, the universities basically said they should have the right to their own intellectual property, i.e. the right to televise their own college football games. The NCAA should not have the right to control that for them, and they won in the Supreme Court. There was a case involving assistant coaches where the NCAA, in a cost-cutting move, tried to cap their pay. They sued. They won. NCAA wound up having to pay, I think, $54 million to settle. But when it comes to 18-year-olds, the courts take a different view, by and large, until O'Bannon, actually. And the courts have basically said, oh, well, you know, this paternalistic system is just fine. And we're not going to apply the same antitrust rigor when it comes to an 18-year-old as we will to a 35-year-old a coach. One idea I had, by the way, I very much like Andy's ideas about how to, about the things, you know, lifetime health insurance and other ways to help athletes short of paying players. And I would add one more, which is a lifetime scholarship. I feel one of the problems, pay notwithstanding, one of the problems is that athletes are expected to work 40 to 50 hours a week and take a full course load of 4 to 5 classes to stay within NCAA rules that they'd be full-time students. Why do they have to be full-time students? Why can't they be part-time students? Why can't you lighten their load while they're eligible to play sports, and then say you can either stay beyond that and finish your degree, you might leave, you might not think college is that important, and you didn't pay that much attention while you were playing, and you decide 10 years later, you know, I really should have gotten that degree, but you should have the right to come back and get that. You've given the university a lot, and the university really owes you. The bargain, The bargain is this. You work your butt off doing something that could hurt you and that takes an enormous amount of your time, and you're generating revenue for the university, and in return, you get a slim chance to become a professional and the chance at an education, which the university makes it almost impossible for you to get because of your job as an athlete. It's a corrupt bargain. The university doesn't, by and large, with too many football and men's basketball players, do not keep their end of the bargain. And a lifetime scholarship would be one way to do it. I want to comment on one thing Matt said, which I agree with. which is
I agree a couple things you said too. So
there we go. We're even. There we go. which is that the subsidies need to go away or are going to go away eventually. I see it through the prism of class more than anything else. You know, many college football players and men's basketball players are poor and come from disadvantaged backgrounds. And what you really have is an enormous wealth transfer from them, who are generating money, to upper middle class kids who play lacrosse. And why is that right? Why is that appropriate? If a university wants a lacrosse team, it should pay for it. Why should the football players pay for it? I understand that I understand the rationale. I just think it's wrong.
Yes, Andy.
Yeah, so I agree with what Matt says about this, which is that by having these transfers from the men's basketball team and the football team, by the way, according to NCAA statistics, on an operating basis, only 50% of the FBS basketball teams have an operating surplus, and 55% of the football teams. So it's not all football teams that are making this transfer, but where there is a transfer, I think it's a good thing. I think that what we're trying to promote here is an an extracurricular activity to a student whose life, at least in prototype, is a sedentary intellectual life as a student. And so you offer dance, you offer theater, you offer music, you offer sports. And this is a complement, and this is what the NCAA says on paper, of course, it's a complement to the developing of a well-rounded student in the university. So if we can have a lacrosse team, a men's lacrosse team or a women's lacrosse team, we're expanding output, that's pro-competitive, it provides more options for the students, and we should be doing that. And this is not a commercial enterprise. If we focus on it strictly as a commercial enterprise, then it's in fact going to be a handful of kids on the football team who are producing the extra surplus that gets transferred. It's not the majority of, it's not the vast majority of the 85 scholarship players, and it's a much, much smaller share of the 120. There are actually 120 students student athletes on a typical FBS football team because there are 35 walk-ons. We can identify that handful of people on the male football team at the Power Five conferences that are helping the continued existence of the women's lacrosse team and the women's track and field team and the men's lacrosse team and so on, and I think that's good.
Well, Joe, you can major in dance, you can major in theater, you can major in music. Maybe you should be able to major in football.
Well, there wouldn't be anything necessarily wrong with creating some sort of... Let me point out where Joe and I agree on... you know, one of the things that
We're going to be best friends, by the way.
Well, one of the things is I think it's absolutely critical to make sure that the student athletes, all of them, have a fair opportunity to get the benefits of the bargain. And the most important component is the educational side. Very, very few people go on and play even a couple years in the NFL or NBA. And if you do, whatever money you make, it's not going to last throughout a normal working life. And you know, one of the things that could be done is, you know, free lifetime educational benefits, assuming that whenever you use up your eligibility or you turn pro, if you're at least in good standing, it's pretty close to zero marginal cost to have additional students. I know I don't get any more money if I've got 75 as opposed to 80. I'm sure same with you. You know, why not graduation bonuses? So you could tie the compensation to, once you earn your degree, yes, then you get some of the fruits of your benefits. But if you don't tie it to that, then it's going to be problematic. One of the things that kind of struck me the most, I was on the PhD dissertation committee for George Kuntz, who was an NFL player for a number of years. George did his dissertation on why are there so many NFL players who are either broke, divorced, substance abuse, all these things after their career ends. And he looked, you know, had access to data that others didn't, and pointed out if you have that kind of unique ability to make it to that level, your whole identity is as a football player. And you might be 24 or 25 or a little bit older when that ends. And if you start paying you know, college athletes more, it's going to just further that sort of thing. And it's not going to be where we're positioning people to take advantage of great athletic ability, good, get a good education, then they're set up for life. That's, you know, basically the, you know, what I would be advocating here.
Okay, we have just a couple more minutes. All right, I would like to hear an elaboration on the idea that Vince put forward, that if you have a pay system, there is some sort of evaluation. You have a tier system with players. There's some sort of evaluation of their ability. And it seems to me, I was a labor economist in my early life. It seems to me you're introducing merit boards here that have a terrifically complicated and contentious history in the private sector and in the public spotlight of the sports arena. I think those problems would be very much magnified. Address that a little more. How do you view that working?
Well, I mean, evaluation goes on in sports all the time. I mean, it's central.
Yeah.
It's central to the product. You're on the first team. You're on the second team. You're on the team. You're cut. Those evaluations are made all the time. It's one of a coach's primary responsibilities. You know, that isn't going to change. All we're doing is applying that and attaching, you know, salary levels to that. As far as that board that I mentioned there that would adjudicate, and we're talking, by the way, relatively small dollars here. We're not awarding millions of dollars here. So we're talking about somebody making $20,000 who maybe played more than was originally envisioned. Decision is that he's going to make $24,000. I mean, you would have to submit to this system and agree, you know, not to challenge it in courts. There's been a lot of talk about the legal side of this today, and rightly so. I'm glad Matt's here to do it. But the reason the courts are involved in this is because somebody resisted something or somebody wanted to enforce something. If there was a general agreement between labor and management here, you know, the courts only get involved when someone comes and asks them to get involved. You know, the legalities here exist because, on one hand, the NCAA has resisted change and has fought the O'Bannon case for how much, a decade or more, maybe, I guess?
4 or 5 years.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Ed O'Bannon could have showed up and said, hey, here's what I think we ought to do. You know, shouldn't we get some of that endorsement money? And the NCAA, in what would have probably been another universe, I guess, could have said, gee, that's a good idea, Ed. We'll give you the money. If that had happened, the courts never probably would have been involved. Now, that's not realistic, I understand. But at some point, you know, for any kind of advancement to be made, and you may recall one of the things I said, that if there's advancement going to be made in this at all, it's going to be incremental, you know. Both sides are going to have to come to some kind of agreement. If it's going to, if everything, every submission goes to court, it's going to take as long as the O'Bannon case took, and, you know, that's forever, essentially, you know. So, yeah, assessment would be difficult. A board judging it sounds onerous, but I don't think that it really would be if everybody submitted to the process and accepted it as it was. But, you know, for this thing to advance, it's going to take, you know, some giving on both sides, and, you know, the history with the NCAA has not been good in that area.
Okay, any last comment? Anybody want to say something before we wrap up? All right, let us thank our panel again. This has been very thought-provoking. Now we're going to have a short break, 10-12 minutes, please.
Okay, we're going to begin the second panel, and when Professor Dunn and I were thinking about hosting this conversation, we were excited to hear from experts, as we heard from earlier this morning, but we were extremely excited to hear from athletes. And so we have some distinguished athlete alums from OSU who are going to share their perspective on this very important and controversial issue. We have joining us on the panel today Lawrence Funderburk. He is the founder and executive director of the Lawrence Funderburk Youth Organization. He is a retired NBA player, a three-time All-Big Ten performer, and you can find information on him. He's also an author of three books, Hook Me Up, Playa, The Triangle Formula of Success, and the forthcoming book, Socio-Psychonomics, How Social Classes Think, Act, and Behave Financially in the 21st Century. You can reach him and his foundation at thundermaxfitness.com. We also have joining us John Holman, who is the head football coach, the Buckeye Local High School, a Buckeye defensive tackle from 2011 to 2015. Marcella Packer, the assistant athletic director at the Columbus School for Girls, the director of the girls' Ohio youth basketball. She was a Lady Buckeye and a guard on the basketball team from 2004 to 2008. We have Sean Springs, who is the CEO of Windpack, sports commentator for Comcast Sportsnet and NBC Sports. He is an NFL veteran and a former Buckeye, Ohio State cornerback from 1994 to 1996. Kelly Trent is the LPGA head professional and a former golf coach. She is an Ohio State University alum. And we have Kristen Watt, who is a partner at Vores, Sater, and Seymour, and Please, LLP. She is the voice of the Lady Buckeyes, a former forward for the Lady Buckeyes from 1981 to 1985, and Maurice Clarette, former running back for the Ohio State Buckeyes. Our moderator is Jim Trelevin, president and CEO of VS Strategy Group and professor of business at the University of Illinois.
Well, this panel, I think, is really important. We've heard a lot of ideas about and a great outline of the issues that exist today in college sports. But the people that are most affected are the athletes, and so we're very fortunate to have the panel today representing the athletes. But I want to make one quick plug for, what was the term you used, Kelly? Tag-along sports? Coattail sports, okay. it came up earlier. There are 1,000 NCAA college members of the NCAA. There are over half a million NCAA athletes representing all three divisions, a variety of sports, and I want to make sure that those are considered. And Andy Zimbalist made a great plug for the value of those sports as part of the educational process. I don't want to narrow the discussion about college athletics to the fact that athletics is, I think as Joe described it, as hard work where you can get injured and it's terrible. Most of those 500,000 athletes play the sport for the love of the sport and for the education they get through playing that sport. And then we have all of those types of sports represented, so it's going to be a great panel. What I'd like the panel members to do in addition to their individual remarks is if they could comment on some of the suggestions that were made in the first panel. There were a portfolio of suggestions that ranged from pretty drastic changes to the way sports is administered, particularly in upper level Division I schools, such as Ohio State, and some tweaking to the system that might make a lot of sense. So I think if you could all respond to some of those ideas, that would be extremely valuable. And in the interest of plugging those sports, Joe mentioned earlier that 66,000, and because of the weather, I think it'll be closer to 100,000 people will show up for the spring game tomorrow. The NCAA Men's Gymnastics Championships is taking place here at St. John Arena this weekend. It starts this afternoon. My son was a gymnast here at Ohio State. It ends tomorrow night with the finals tomorrow night, and it does not conflict with the spring game, so you can go to both. So with that, we're going to go left to right on the panel. And first up will be Lawrence Funderburk.
I thought it was a very enlightening discussion. A lot of points were made. And obviously, the whole debate of economic fairness, when we take that position, it's very divisive. I'm of the position of student empowerment. That's my position. That's how I am. That's how I've always lived my life. But I think some points that were made in terms of what do you do? How do you make it fair, or how do you try to level the playing field, I guess? I like the idea of, health insurance, so income replacement. I have five different points that I have that I will share when I speak, but I think there are some things that can be done to protect athletes if they get hurt or if they want to continue their education. I know the university already has it where if you here at this university, you leave school without a degree, you can actually come back and finish your education. So that's kind of a moot point. That is already there. The problem is very few athletes, as some have indicated, take academics seriously. And I think that's the issue, and that's going to be something that I jump into when I get going.
Next up, John Holman.
I'd like to say, excuse my voice, I'm Woke up this morning, thought I was going to be singing, but I guess not. but I like to agree. I think Matt brought the issue up about once they graduate, allowing them to have some type of funding. So I thought maybe the school makes a crazy amount of money, not just Ohio State. I think when I was, well, I know when I was a student here, played football here, worked four jobs, and went to school as well. Mm-hmm. So you're probably wondering, how in the heck did you do that? Not a lot of sleep. I made a lot of sacrifices at the end of the day. And ultimately, my grades suffered and my performance suffered on the field. But at the same time, I realized that I loved the school and I wanted to do everything I could. But he made up a point that once you graduate, maybe you guys, they offer students, you know, maybe $10,000 to $15,000 per year that goes into a savings account, which allows them, once they graduate, maybe accumulate $60,000 or $70,000. Once they graduate, they're allowed to go into that account and take that money out, because most of the student athletes, once they graduate, are either going back home to wherever they're from and it's nothing there, or going to the NFL, but the majority of them are going back home. And they got an opportunity to come to a great university like the USA University, go to Alabama or such and such schools or whatever, and at the end of the day, they get nothing. So I think having some system where once they graduate, it's a win-win situation. The school keeps their graduation well. The students, athletes are allowed to have money as far as starting their own business or being successful once they get done graduating from college.
Thank you, John. Marcella?
Well, first, the first panel gave me a lot to think about. I was actually sitting there like, wow, maybe I should change my stance. but I think being a former women's basketball player, I had a lot of different experiences than what men's basketball and obviously football players may have had. Academics were always very important on our team. You were looked down upon if you were getting below a 3.0, and we never ever considered getting paid to play the sport. It was enough just to be getting our education paid for. But hearing stories like this, I mean, you working so many jobs in schools definitely made me rethink some things and how we could probably make some adjustments. But what comes to mind for me is not just football and basketball, but the other sports that we have here, especially at Ohio State, and how they would be affected by that. I don't think a lot of women's basketball players are thinking of going professional when they're in college. They're thinking about their education, what their opportunities that may come after that, and I think that would be a big factor in if this did happen, if athletes did start getting paid to play.
Thanks. Sean?
It was great first panel. Great, it was awesome. Being in Washington, D.C., I'm so used to all the politics. You kind of like the politics of the Hill. And I will say that I've seen an agreement, a proposal to the NCAA through Senator Watt, J.C. Watts, and he proposed this long agreement with, I think it was Marsh, the workers' comp group. And those guys proposed, and the three main points came out of that big proposal to the NCAA was a guaranteed four-year scholarship, lifetime benefits if a player is injured and the scholarship is over, lifetime benefits, and there was some type of evaluation for a stipend, and I think that was one of the third points, you know, negotiating the stipends through insurance. One of the things we always talk about, how do you value an athlete, and one guy, I think it was Joe, he was talking about, well, we should give a guy $20,000 in different money, and I think that brings great point to pay athletes, but as an athlete, you don't want to get too much money, right? Because we have a whole different issue. We worried about child support or something like that on campus. A whole different issue, but we there's a lot of social issues that we would get into.
Wow.
But I will say this, but I want to get this point across. As a Ohio State, and I'm so proud of this university putting this on, because a lot of time what's overlooked is, yeah, you want to pay athletes, and we love to play the sport. But I will say, and maybe hopefully everybody agrees with this, when I came to Ohio State, I was passionate about football, and I felt that there was no brand bigger than the Ohio State brand. So I played because I loved the university, and I played because of the tradition, of players who came before, like my father Ron, who played here, and Neil Cozy and Archie Griffin, and you can go back 100 years of winning football here at Ohio State.
So when we talk about student athletes, I think we gotta take in the fact that, yeah, there's recruitment, there's big facilities and different things, but I think guys really are passionate about the sport, and yeah, they need to be compensated, but they play because they love the game and they love the brand of that school. And we'll get into all the rest of that. I'm gonna talk.
Kelly?
Hi, I want to thank the panel for inviting me, for one. I'm probably the oldest one up here, is my guess, looking at the faces.
Except on this end.
Yeah. The first panel was very intriguing and very interested. Interesting. My story is quite different. My goal was, when I walked into the university, I made it real clear, I was a two-year product and I was out of here. And that was made clear to the coach when they recruited me. That was made clear to anyone else involved who ever asked me. And I had a great first year. Awesome first year. Won everything there was to win in golf. First woman to win the Big Tens and first Big Ten women's team. So it was pretty incredible. The bad news is, come sophomore quarter, they're looking at me being ineligible. I came to Ohio State, literally couldn't read or write. Could write down scores, could sign my name, but that's about it. Came from the South, horrible education. And it was like, oh my God, our star golfer is, we're screwed. And so they spent mega dollars getting me caught up, diagnosing me with dyslexia, severe dyslexia, and getting me to a point where, you know, I actually liked studying and I liked education, and it was kind of a cool thing. And I continued on to play and did very well here at Ohio State. And thinking about all the pay to play and all the money they invested in my education is phenomenal. Not only the education, I actually graduated, by the way, in 4 years. Yay. So, you know, I feel I'm kind of on the fence with all this. I totally get where football, basketball, you know, it is tough. We had a couple people on our team that didn't come from a very financially good background, and they earned full rides. They couldn't work. So for them to go to Wendy's, it couldn't happen. Okay, they couldn't do that. For them to buy toothpaste sometimes, it couldn't happen. Because, you know, it was back in the day where, you know, you didn't have those things. And you were expected to play tournaments in the summer, and you had to figure out how you were going to pay for those and what you were going to do. And so that left no time to really work. And I think that there needs to be some economic across the board, not only for your incoming or your revenue sports, but as somebody said, coattail sports, which I think that's what I would fall under. But it's got to be something that's equitable for all sports, because I think the one thing we don't want to lose is that we are athletes. The university is giving us an education. And, you know, they're giving you something that a lot of kids aren't going to get with this high cost as education is coming in this day and time. So the student loans, I know, are astronomical with kids coming out. And so I feel incredibly privileged to be able to say I'm an Ohio State graduate, one. And two, it's amazing they gave my life back. That's cool. So, in that, I guess, you know, I get angry with you guys, get the pens and you get stuff, you know. You know, that's
okay,
cool,
okay.
But you know what, they give it to you. You should be able to sell it, it's yours, okay? It's not the university's. Once they give it to you, it's yours, sell it, it's okay. You know, I mean, that's a big thing that's been in my arsenal or whatever. It's like, that bothered me when all that stuff came down, because they do give you stuff. And, you know, some people need to sell it to make it through. They just do. So I think we have a long way to go. I think that there's going to be a lot of different views on this for a long time, and it's like politics. Who knows when we'll get to the right answer, and if it'll be fair, and if it will be equitable for everyone. But I hope it is one day. Thank you.
I think that's an excellent comment. The purpose of this panel is to begin and foster that dialogue, which is Kristen.
Well, probably being the second oldest then, maybe the third if we're
third, yes.
I fall in the camp of I don't want it to become professional sports. I like the amateurism. I am all over the board with certain things, and talking about this has been really, really cathartic for me. I played on a team in the early 80s, and when I came to the big city, I was also dyslexic. Though I had caught it earlier in my career. And I loved all the things that Ohio State could afford me. I loved the education, I loved the team, my teammates, which we were all over socioeconomic backgrounds. I loved being able to be a part of a team that I learned more about the rest of the world than my little 7,000 person hometown. I loved being able to have tutors. I loved being able to never be closed out of a class. You know, when you're an athlete at most universities, you're never closed out of a class. That's because you have a schedule that's very important. And when I have practice from 2 to 3, and if there's 3 accounting classes, I was an accounting undergrad, and there's only one that falls outside that time period, I'm pretty much guaranteed I can get that class, which helps you stay on schedule to get your degree on time. We were the only women's sport, and may still be today, that had training table where we were given dinner. Normally that's just football and basketball. At Ohio State it was also women's basketball. All of those things plus a fabulous education. I mean, I truly think I grew the most in my first 4 or 5 years at Ohio State as a person ever. And that's because what being a student athlete was for me. And to me, I want to keep it student athlete. Do I think there are things wrong? Absolutely. But just like everything else out there in society, you know, healthcare, is it perfect out there?
No.
Far from it. But I think there are things we can do here to make it better. Will it be perfect? No. But that's kind of the way we are in society. And so, overall, I want to keep it a student-athlete experience, because I think those are the types of things that when you leave here, whether you leave here in 1 year, 2 years, 4 years, 5 years, I graduated 2 quarters late, when you leave here, it's the things that you take away from being a student-athlete that and my education that has launched me for the rest of my career. And I want that to still be that way. I don't want it to be a minor league team. And I want to make sure that we think about everybody on the panel is talking football, basketball. Basketball, football. Football, basketball. Ohio State has what, 32 sports?
36.
36. 36. 36. If you, the pot of money is unlike some people, I do believe it will have an end at some point. And I hate to see what happens to, like, Miami University when they lost their men's baseball team and wrestling and things like that because of Title IX. Love Title IX. I'm a beneficiary of it. But I don't want the money to be funneled such that you have other people in other sports who might not be the UA lacrosse player, but you may be the West Virginia wrestler or the Huron, Ohio basketball player. And I want to make sure that we don't cut off our nose to spite our face, and we provide it to everyone as best we can. Are there inequities? Yes. Will there always be inequities? Yes. Are there things we can fix? Absolutely, and I think we should. And forums like this, I really want to congratulate Ohio State for putting this on. It's kind of a ballsy move. I like it. you know, the more we talk about it, the more issues get out, the more people get educated. I know the last 2 days I've been more educated on this issue, and I'm better for it. And I think the more we talk, everyone will be that way. And that's what spurs or help spur changes in the conversation, the dialogue. And so I'm just delighted to be part of the panel.
Thanks, Chris and Maurice.
Yes. Hey, how everybody doing? Well, I got a different perspective because I was directly affected by a lot of this here, exactly. And a lot of the stuff that the guys, the panelists spoke about, you know, it was a lot of new and enlightening stuff with me. But I think the first one, should athletes be paid? And I say absolutely. And my whole spiral of events don't take place if I have money for a cell phone, if I have money for food, if I have money to fix a transmission for my car. I'm poor and I'm black, right, coming from Youngstown. The second part of that, it's a business coming into the program. First of all, from the enrolling process, it's altered to for student athletes to come in for the sole reasoning we need inner city black kids who wouldn't normally fit the enrollment requirements to come to our school and generate money. So when I came into Ohio State, I couldn't read very well, couldn't write very well, had a 13 or 14 on my ACT or whatever it was. And when I came in, there was curriculum, and I preface this by saying, we talk about spending and giving athletes money, that's one thing, but the bigger issue is that, are they getting a real education? And we don't get a real education. I've been to Alabama, Tennessee, Notre Dame, Florida, Florida State, and probably 30 or 40 universities within the last 18 months. I'm not talking about distance in the past. And when you see these kids, they can barely talk, they can barely read, mm-hmm. they can barely write, and the coursework that they get is inadequate and not useful. I always go into these programs and I say, hey, would your head coach or would any of you on this panel put your kids in African American studies classes? Would you put your kids in women's studies and all these other nonsense courses? And the answer is no. And the reason that they don't care is because these kids go back to the ghetto. Mm-hmm. They go back to the ghetto. Only thing they have to do is basically offer up camps to the inner city kids, and they create the same cycle of ignorance, right? Mm-hmm. And the coaches know it's BS from the beginning, but nobody says nothing. I took women's studies when I was here. I took African American studies when I was here. I took independent studies, which you're not supposed to take until you're a junior, but since Maurice Claret generates revenue and we need him on the field, let's alter this situation and put him in an independent study course. The kid believes that he's getting over on the program, but not realizing that only 2% from this population shall go on, and out of the 2% that does go on, they're staying for 4 years. They might stay for 4 years if they're lucky. You know what I'm saying? So if we know all these facts, it's like it's almost even crazy to even have this discussion. I wish in some capacity they can live stream this stuff to kids now. Now we have the technology, and I wish you had a bunch of smart people who can craft and break it down how much money and everything that actually entails inside this thing. And I'm only speaking from the perspective of the football player. I can't name about all the sports, you know, so I respectfully say it. But at the same time, I just wish that kids these days and their parents set out the same way that those Missouri kids set out. And you know why they came up with an answer very, very quick? It's because you stopped everybody's money. You stopped Urban Meyer's money. You stopped Nick Saban's money. You stopped the TV money. You stopped everything. I found out very quick when I challenged the NFL for early entry. Once you try to mess up somebody's money, people come up with answers real quick, very quick, right? And so the seriousness of the situation is if you have all these kids and all their parents realize, like, hey, there's a lot of money circulating around. My kid's really not getting an education. My kid has basket weaving at the end of the day. My kid gets classes tutored for him, and the kids walk across the stage, and they hold up paper, and they hold up degrees. But I just had a kid graduate from here who was on a national championship team. He calls me up. He said, hey, Maurice, I got a degree in financial planning, but if you look at his coursework, it's nonsense. And he says, how do I buy a car? Mm. Right, but he has a degree from Ohio State that says some sort of financial planning. Mm. It's nonsense, you know what I'm saying? And so nobody wants to talk about it because it doesn't affect your Upper Arlington, your Dublin, your Worthington, and places like that.
That's right. Keep preaching.
Directly back, but I'll stop right there. But
no, keep preaching. I'm saying keep preaching. Keep going. Keep preaching.
I mean, I was affected by this stuff, and so I'm very sensitive to it. But I've had solutions for a long time. You know what I'm saying? And I'm not in a situation. I'm not in multiple situations if this thing is restructured. And now that I've had a chance to sit back and look at it, and like, man, you know, this thing is designed. And it's exploited by, you're exploiting your inner city black kids who predominantly go to these universities and generate the money, period. Mm-hmm. If you look at all around the country, there are inner city black kids who don't speak very well, who are not educated, who get pushed through the system in high school, come to college unprepared. There's no coursework on the campus that they can take. So you put them in these lollipop classes. It's like, okay, how about this? How about we just put them with learning specialists and say, hey, this is a real job and this is a real thing, and take some of their solutions. They're a lot smarter than me in regards to the economics and the tax breaks and all that stuff. I don't understand that stuff.
I can speak from this perspective, though, and I can say, hey, you know, they definitely need to be compensated because they say, yeah, you get an education. You're getting stuck into a class and pushed along and, hey, take this piece of paper so we can say we graduate 85% of the kids and give it to an alumni and say, hey, we graduated football players. Okay, I get some football seats and, okay, cool, they graduated, but it doesn't mean nothing. How about we go do a film on where these guys are at now? You know what I'm saying? And so I'm pretty sure, Sean, you know, you probably have guys who graduated that you play with who are bums. And, right. and no disrespect to them, you know, they're 40, 50, 60 years old, still running football camps because they've not learned nothing from here. Yeah. And to Lawrence's point, I tried to come back to Ohio State, and I met with a gentleman over at the athletic office, and I said, hey, can I finish up my degree? And it's actually a curriculum that if I didn't have 3 years in, I wasn't able to come back here and finish my degree. And I tried to do this in 2011. And so that isn't the case. It actually, there's circumstances. Mm. To you actually being able to come back.
Yeah, to leave on good. Yeah, to leave on good standing.
Good standing,
right?
Okay, in that first round, we heard some conflicting views of the life of a student athlete as a student, and Maurice's comments are consistent with Joe Nocera's comments that academic support at universities is really designed to keep players eligible and not to help them get educated. So I'd like to throw out a question to the two-part question to the panel, which is particularly because Kristen and Kelly had a different view of the process. One is Ohio State has a very large investment in SASO, which is the academic support department within the athletic department. Do you think they view their role as keeping you eligible or helping you get educated? That's part one. Mm. Part two is, coattail sports, is because the All-American football players need to be eligible to generate revenue. Is keeping them eligible the main objective? But for the coattail sports, or all the non-revenue sports, is helping them get educated more important because it doesn't affect revenue? And I don't know if that, so I throw that out to the panel to comment on part A and B.
Can I start on one part there, Maurice? You brought up a good point. I think the point you brought up about guys with degrees go back to their communities and they recycle this process. We both played at Ohio State, and I think I was pretty good. You might have been better than I was at Ohio State. but all seriousness, I think it starts at the parent level, too. And that is important for us to understand the cycle because my view is totally different. I already knew coming into school after my freshman year, I was going to be a top five pick. I just knew it because I saw Eddie. I saw Joy, and I figured if I can cover Joy, I can go to the league, right? So that's how I looked at it, right? Terry Glenn, you're pretty good, but I can cover you, so I'm okay, right? I see what you're doing to just Deion and Rod Woodson in the NFL. But the difference was my father stayed on me. My dad, Ron, made sure that it wasn't just going to be like a degree where you just go and whatever happens in football, you don't make it. My father was very tough on me, and I think a lot of times, you know, it's the school and John Mackle, who was my advisor, and those guys there try to push you into classes, but you have to be educated from, and it's that cycle. We got to break that cycle in the black community of like what Lawrence is doing, what these guys are doing. I'm saying, listen, man, just because you got a degree and you might be a top, thank God for Ohio State, I was top three corner, I'm the highest corner ever drafted in the history of the NFL, thanks to Ohio State. But my mom and my dad always told me, like, still work on it, grind, work on your academics, work on that, and break that cycle. You know, my father was always upset because he didn't finish his degree, so he was extra hard on me. So even when I left as a junior, I went and took classes while I was playing for Seattle at University of Washington, and then came back and got my degree because it was important to me, even though I was already in the NFL, I had already put up money for generations for my family because I was a high draft pick. But that cycle that he's talking about was broken from my father, Ron. So that answer, the university does push guys through, but we got to take upon ourselves to make sure that we understand the importance of education.
My fault. Can you say it again? The question again, the whole question.
Oh, two parts. One is Ohio State invests a lot in academic support for athletes.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
SASO is a big department.
Gotcha.
Provides a lot of support for athletes. So the question is, based on Joe Nocera's comment from the first panel, do you think they view their role as keeping you eligible or helping you get a good education? One. Part two is,
okay,
do you think it's different for you because you were a star football player versus a star golfer? Do they treat the different sports differently in that regard?
Yeah, I mean, I think the fact that you're even asking a question, you pretty much know the answer. You know what I'm saying? And I can only speak for myself. You know what I mean? And I know people in SASO, and I think it's just a case-by-case situation. SASO's not stupid. They understand who generates the money. They understand who the football team needs. And so they're going to align you with the appropriate tutor or the appropriate athletic infrastructure based upon your needs. And they know a lot of these guys can't read very well and write very well. And you'll grab a young tutor or somebody and say, hey, won't you just go ahead and assist the gentleman in remaining eligible? So I can't speak to golf or to any other sport, but it definitely goes on. And just to kind of build on what Sean said, the only thing I was saying in reference to guys only being able to come back and offer camps to the neighborhood, these are the most influential people out of most inner city neighborhoods. And so when I came back to my hometown and the only thing that I was offering up was football camps, I was like, man, I got the influence over so many people. I can grab hundreds of people and all over the state of Ohio. You know, and if the only thing that I basically can offer them is some football drills, I really kind of failed myself and failed them. And when you kind of see it go over and over again, and that's what I was really referencing to, but I can't speak to the things with women's sports.
Yeah, I can remember study table required to go every night, Sunday through Thursday. And I can tell you, I felt like, personally for me, I was getting the same thing as the football players were getting. I mean, great tutors, great folks helping me. Marcus Merritt and I, actually, we were paired together, and he and I had the same tutor through because he was diagnosed with dyslexia and had a lot of the same issues I did. And so he and I were paired together, and we had the same counselor the first 6 months to a year, I think it was, that we went through this. But, I mean, you know, you guys make great points. I mean, it's a different culture. It's totally different. And, you know, again, there's got to be some equity. I don't know what the answer is. I don't think anybody right now knows what the answer is. But, I mean, we need to see, I think, more college athletes graduate. And the biggest reason is, football players, basketball players, you can't do it that long. I mean, what are you going to do when you're done? And if you haven't had money management, if you hadn't had somebody teach you what to do, and a lot of them don't. It's like you guys said, a lot of them are dirt poor, broke, and they made millions, you know? And, you know, I think that's a big, that was, I know, a big thing with my particular situation. You know, I didn't know how to manage money. I'm the first person to ever graduate from college in my family. And, you know, the only one as of right now. So, you know, it's one of those things. I think that's what we need to teach. There's other things that we need to teach. There's things that are important. And I think coming back to college, I think he should have the right. He gave 1 year, won a national championship. Yeah, he screwed up. He made mistakes.
Thanks.
But there's no one in this room that can go out of here and say they haven't made mistakes, okay? But guess what? We should give him his college education. I mean, that's how I feel. We should give him his college education.
I just want to step in because when I came here, like many people who come to Ohio State, you're highly recruited. You're one of the best of the best. And I came here and I was not a starter. I was not someone that people were, hey, Kristen, well, you've got to make sure you go to class because we need to keep you eligible. I was not one of those people, but I had teammates who were also like me that were not starters, that were struggling in class, and they did get help. The one thing that I thought the coaching staff did a very good job of, and that was, again, a coaching staff thing, is making sure that everybody understood the importance of an education. And the one thing that I would like to piggyback on what Maurice is saying is about, you know, educating people about education.
Right.
what Sean's saying. You really need, and people kind of joked, I don't know if it was joking or not, on the first panel about, why can't you get a degree in football? Well, you know, maybe there are degrees that you don't go out and you become a social worker or an accountant. You become a person that's ready to go out into the world. You know how to buy a car. Mm-hmm. You know how to take notes in class. A lot of people didn't know how to do that.
Didn't know.
You figure it out, or you sink or swim. I went to one quarter study table, and if you got over a certain GPA, you graded out, and I graded out. I made sure it was a 2.75, and I had a 2.84 my first quarter here, and I made darn sure that I was not going to go to study table because I didn't like it. If I needed help in a class, I could go, and it was my decision. But I think people need to understand, and the education that some people are or aren't getting to be ready to come to school, I think it's part of the school's process that they need to do that. And I find it insulting to sit here, because I thought Ohio State had a program where you could come back and get a degree, to find out that you asked and you were told no. I'm appalled by that.
They're just different requirements. You know, it's not like I'm saying, like, there was requirements, and I'm just saying to myself, I was like kind of looking at the person, like, I helped generate a lot of money for this place. I'll say it, right? Helped to bring in recruits the whole nine. I was like, at least I can do is get an education paid for. And I know where the money's at. I know where it's, you know, all that stuff, but that's a whole different story.
Well, yeah, I just think you should be able to get an education. And I do think that your education, when you sign up, should be a 4-year requirement.
Yep.
When I came to Ohio State and I realized after the fact that, okay, I'm not a starter, and what do you mean it's 1 year? There's a lot of stress associated with that.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm going to kick it in the classroom, and I'm going to be a really good practice player, and I'm going to work hard every day. Because I was like, I want to make sure I keep my scholarship. And I think it would relieve a lot of people that aren't starters, that are on an 84-person football team, that maybe come in and say, okay, yeah, you're not a starter. Maybe you're third string or you have an injury, but you don't have to worry about keeping your scholarship. I do believe that you should get a 4-year scholarship.
Yeah. Any other comments on parts A and B? Marcella.
I was very fortunate enough to, I'm from Pickerington, went to high school there, so very good, you know, education come out of Pickerington. But I would say I was majoring in basketball in high school for sure. The best class I took, and I think prepared me for life, was personal finance while I was there. When I went through the recruiting process, I was all everything coming out of high school. And during those recruiting visits, my mother was always pushing me. My dad was about basketball, my mom was about academics, you know, so I had a good balance in the household. And she always told me would I want to go to a school regardless of playing basketball, because I won't be able to play it forever. And I remember being recruited, I was down at Tennessee with Pat Summit, and I was appalled at the communication building, and that's what I wanted my major to be. And that was helpful in my decision in not going there and deciding to come to Ohio State. So academics were always important in the household, and I think that was a huge factor for me. As far as being supported by SASO, I felt like I was, top notch at SASO, just because I could go there and print, I had tutors, I mean, everyone was always there to support me. It was nice not to have to go with the rest of the student body where they had to go print and have issues with that. I never had to deal with that. Coaches were always very supportive, helping me go through a syllabus and outline it, you know, what was important when assignments were coming up. So there was always a push there to graduate. And I always had the mentality of I didn't want to be the ripe age of 30, old age of 30, and playing basketball. And I actually, you know, stopped playing professionally overseas to go back to school and kind of do other things. I want to be more than a basketball player. So I think it goes back to Marie saying, and Sean, you know, your background and how you're taught and what's value growing up. But I'm definitely surprised to hear some of the things that are going on at Ohio State, and maybe not having some athletes that were supported as much as I was.
Thanks. I have several more multi-part questions, but before we get to those, Lawrence has some comments that he would like to make as well.
Yes.
First of all, I know most people keep asking, there's a kid named Derek Funderburk who's coming here. He's not my son. I tell my wife's like, man, is there some kids that I don't know about?
Spelled different.
And I have an E on my end of my name. He doesn't. So get that out of the way. Also, whenever I come to a venue like this, I like to get a feel for the audience, what they think. And I asked a young lady, a student here, I said, well, what are your thoughts? And she talked about, well, I'm here. I'm just trying to gain some information. And I think by and large, you know, most of the athletes that are come to this university or that are here right now don't take their academics seriously. And that's very troubling on a number of fronts. Charlie Scott, those of you, if you're over 45, you know Charlie Scott, you know his story. His son, Shannon Scott, who was a star basketball player here. Charlie was the first African-American athlete on scholarship at the University of North Carolina in the midst of racism and all of that and what he went through. And I spoke with him, and he didn't have any bitterness or anything how he was treated. We were at the Final Four a few years ago, and he said, Lawrence, I'm all about preparing my son. He said, it's not about the next 4 years, it's about the next 40 years. Mm-hmm. And that's what college is about. It should prepare you, it should catapult you, your opportunities, your networking, your educational advancement. That's what college should prepare you for. Because this issue is very seriously, as everyone just articulated there, here today, and it's about lives and legacies. That's really what it's about when it talks about young folks. And the term student-athlete is an oxymoron. Student-athlete. Really? Student-athlete? And there's culpability on both sides with this whole issue here. And with the so-called student-athlete, and also the university. Is it up higher learning or instinctive learning? Now, if the athlete doesn't have a game plan or playbook for his life or her life, then they're going to continue to get pimped by the system. Now, and also the universities in the two revenue-generating sports, if an athlete comes to this university or any university and leaves no better off when they started, then the university has failed them through gross negligence. That's what they failed them through. Now, my story, I came here very similar to a lot of kids. I was a top five high school recruit coming out of college. I was actually second, rated even ahead of Shaquille O'Neal, but we know who had a better career. Every school in the country wanted me. Every school wanted me, told me how great I was, promised me everything. I grew up in a very difficult environment. I grew up on welfare. I carry a food stamp with me to this day as a constant reminder of the stench of poverty. I was on a government scholarship. We were totally dependent on the government to live, to eat, everything. Very dysfunctional, never knew my father, saw my father three times my whole life. My father never one time told me that he loved me. Like a lot of young men who come to school, you're very bitter, very distrustful, particularly of white males, because you don't have a father figure in your life. And I remember having a conversation with Thad Mata of this basketball season, and it was the beginning of the season, they were practicing, I was gonna be a keynote speaker to some alumni, and he started talking. He said, Lawrence, when I get done with basketball, I wanna start a nonprofit organization that works with inner city black males, because there's so many black males who come to school here, they're so distrustful of me. And I have to earn their trust. And I said, it's pretty simple. When you don't have father figures in your life, when you have people who promise you that they're gonna be there and they never show up, you're very distrustful, and particularly of a system that uses you for what you can give on the court or the football field, but not your intellectual capabilities. Now, I am against paying athletes. I'm against it. Because when athletes don't take advantage of the situation and allow the situation or the opportunity to take advantage of them, they have some blame to go along. And what does this lead to? Academic indifference, reckless behavior. What are they going to take seriously? Not much. Not much at all. Now, when you pay college athletes, you handicap them. I've had multiple surgeries. When I was coming here, whenever I speak to young people in prison, I speak to young people all over the country. I always bring crutches. I bring crutches because that's what a lot of young people do. And if we start paying them, if we start making it easier for them, that's going to perpetuate even more that I'm a professional athlete. That's what's going to perpetuate. And money is going to magnify your deficits. I made millions and millions and millions of dollars playing pro sports. A lot of guys made a lot more money than me. Most guys end no better off when they leave the professional ranks than when they enter. I wrote a book about it, Hook Me a Player, okay, before it broke came out. I wrote this book many years before that. And as Gareth Sayre said, athletes need to think about the beginning of the end of their career at the beginning of their career. That's what they need to do. That's their responsibility, coach's responsibility to do that. Because once you go into the phone booth as Superman and you come out, you're permanently Clark Kent. And that day is over, you playing basketball, that's it. You can't go in there anymore and put that suit on. Now, when you feel taken advantage of, you feel exploited, you feel entitled, you feel old. I grew up in that environment. I know a lot about being old or feeling entitled, growing up on welfare, right here. Now, here's the implied recruitment manifesto of big-time athletic departments. My wife, she knows I'm a bit controversial. She says, I think that's a little too edgy, Lawrence, but I'm going to share this anyway. I love my wife. I've been married for 17 years. I met her here at this university. Many big-time athletic departments are beholden, right? They hold the universities captive, right, through athletics. And here's what the recruitment manifesto that I come up with. The only things that matters to us is your athletic abilities. We don't value your intellectual capabilities. As a matter of fact, we know what's best for you. And we're going to guide you into a meaningless degree or no degree, just so you stay eligible and, above all else, compliant in thought, in word, and deed. You will receive a free education, room and board, and media exposure, not to mention fringe benefits as the BMOC. That stands for Big Man on Campus. As you tear your bodies up in the process for this great university, but don't worry. Don't worry if this happens. We got you covered because we got the best money that doctors can buy. Now, think as less as possible and concentrate only from the neck down. At all other times, and don't ever forget this, do what you're told. Do what you're told. Sound fair? Sign right here on the dotted line. Sign right here on the dotted line. Now, we make excuses a lot for athletes. And we say they can't squeeze any more on their plate. A lot of folks have talked about finance. I have 3 degrees. And the longer I stayed in college, the more it hurt me when it came time to be drafted. If I would have left school early after my sophomore year, I would have been a lottery pick for sure. But I stayed and I promised my mom and I promised myself that I knew education was very important for me. I graduated in business finance from this university, magna cum laude. A lot of those professors didn't like academics. Athletics and academics, a lot of times academics take a back seat to athletics, as Cindy mentioned when I was talking to her. I also have a master's degree in business administration. I got that, my MBA, when I was playing in the NBA, because I knew one day the basketball would stop bouncing. I'm also a certified financial planner. So I have 3 degrees. Kids who come in this university can get one, or you can come back and get one. I know college is not for everybody, but everybody needs an education. Because education, intellectual stimulation, and a 40-year playbook is so important. Now, paying college athletes. Here's my 5-point plan. If we're going to pay athletes, there's some things that we have to do. Number one, we should definitely have some type of life skills program. Athletes come to me all the time, and what they tell me is, I don't know how to, as Marie said, I don't know how to talk. I don't know how to communicate. I don't know how to network. I don't know how to do anything other than play the sport or talk about how great I was playing. So we need some life skills, but not only for athletes, we need to educate parents too. Because you're taught, and they look at you as the meal ticket to get out of the bad situation. Most inner city kids feel that way. Life skills is very important. Who should teach them? Athletes who've blazed the trail. And you know what? You gotta pay them. I'm tired of universities expecting me to come back here for free. I'm a professional. You gotta pay me. You gotta pay me, and I'm good at what I do. So that's number one. Mentoring arrangement. Every athlete should have a mentor, someone who guides him or her along. Everyone needs that because a mentor can provide a lifetime of education so that you don't have to go through the heartaches. Now, also maybe a supplemental stipend to help with the college scholarship. How much? Not too much, but certainly that can be done. I propose this, a deferred savings or retirement vehicle. Just like employees, when you have to contribute, and you have to be vested. If you leave early, then you don't get that money. I think there should be some type of mechanism, some ties to that. I know some others propose health insurance or income replacement. And then the last one is a family emergency fund. I grew up poor. My mom, when I went to NA University, I went there first and I transferred in conference. It didn't go very well. Me and Bobby Knight didn't work out too well. But a lot of families can't go to games. They don't have the money. They can't physically go. And when I transfer in conference to Ohio State, I wasn't on scholarship. I paid just like my way, just like everybody else. And I think there are some smart approaches that we can do. We're never going to be fair or equitable with this, but we have to be sensible. We can at least all agree to that, agree to this. And where are the adults in the room, right? Where are the adults in the room? We need to be adults because we have hindsight. And I don't really like being a part of this discussion because if it doesn't lead anywhere, time is money to me. I got to get paid. I don't really have time unless I'm really getting paid. But I realize I have to be an advocate for the athletes who come to this university, who come to me all the time. And they say, Lawrence, I need help. Mm-hmm. And that's my spiel.
Thanks, Lawrence. We can tell you were paying attention in finance class in your CFP as well. Related to academics, one question I'd like to throw out, which came up in the first panel as well, one of the panelists suggested that student athletes shouldn't be required to be full-time students. And I'll throw out an alternative to that, which is, because in my kids who went here and were athletes and spent 30, 40 hours a week on their sports, 52 weeks a year, and there was a tension between that and obviously in the academic side. So the question is, take either position, the first panel said you could not be required to be a full-time student. What about if the workloads, which could be mandated by the NCAA, the practice times and all the other activities associated with the sport, those could be reduced as well. So I'm curious as to what you think about those two alternatives.
Oh, I always got something to say.
Go for it.
I got here halfway through the first session, but it doesn't sound bad. Like I say, that was the first time I heard Lawrence kind of break everything down, and I respectfully agree with some of his points. But then, if he spends some time with me, I kind of get him to the pay athletes part eventually. No, but he's only speaking from his perspective. You have to respect people and their perspective. But it doesn't sound like a bad idea. It's definitely a job for these kids. And as I continue to say, these kids are not in a position based upon their athletic requirements to get an appropriate education. And so you push this coursework on them just to flush them through the system, and it really does nothing. So it's not a bad idea, but I keep on saying, I'm with Lawrence on this part. Like, you come to these discussions and nothing happens. I wish that somehow, some way you can live stream this stuff or record it and filter it through to students, the people who it affects, and have their opinions. And I would love for these people to just say, hey, I don't want to play no more basketball, football, hockey, golf, nothing. And then you bring these smart people in the room, and then you talk to the NCAA, and then you shut everything down. And once the money's cut off, then you have a real discussion, because you'd be like, you know what? Nobody's going to get paid. So I bet you Urban Meyer, Nick Saban, everybody get on their planes, and they'll fly over to Indianapolis, and they'll be like, man, we got to figure this thing out. You know what I'm saying?
That's the truth.
We can start right there with that discussion. Because your student athlete supports, all this stuff wouldn't even go on if you have a real discussion about it. Everybody stops. And I bet you everybody gets smart at some point, right? But that's not a bad idea, to say it in jest.
Yeah, I don't think that athletes should be treated any different than all those kids in the back there. You know, I mean, yeah, we're here, we're on scholarship. But as far as course load, I mean, even with the issues I was going through and all of the help that is offered at this university, and I can only speak for here because this is the only place I've ever been, you know, I can't imagine that you can't figure out how to make it work. I mean, I realize that you're lifting football players, basketball players, you're doing all that stuff, and I know golf has changed tremendously now. We have that beautiful new facility over at OSU Golf Course, you know, where they can practice and be in it year-round. But I think that takes it to a whole nother level where, you know, I spent 1 year thinking I was God's gift of whatever. Guess what? I'm not. And I think that's what that portrays is you can't treat people differently. I mean, it's got to be equitable for everyone, including the kid that is coming here paying his own way, but I don't agree with that piece.
Can I say, go ahead. But the fact of life, if everybody is not the same.
They're not the same.
That's why you pay Peyton Manning $1 million a game, and that's why you pay the practice squad player his portion, because everybody doesn't have the same value, and we understand that everywhere else in society. If I went to her law firm and me and her cooped the same money just because I'm employed, you'd be like, oh, you'd probably say, oh, that's crazy. And I'd be like, no, well, we're equal and we're buddies and we're happy and we work for the same company. You know, but she'd be like, no, Maurice, I have more value to the situation.
That's right.
I litigate more, I do everything more because I'm more valuable. So they're not, speaking in my terms, they're not putting practice squad player number 67's jersey in the window. No, they're putting number 13, but we don't put Claret on the back, so it's cool. You know what I'm saying? So everybody becomes dumb. You know, I've never signed anything other than 13 numbers my whole life, right? But the NCAA says, oh, it's not Maurice Claret because it's not his name on the back. You know what I'm saying? So, and I get passionate, but I'm respectful to people. I just says everybody in life doesn't have the same value to what they're pushing and promoting. So there's nothing wrong with treating people based upon their contribution to the situation.
No, I agree. I mean, as athletes, I mean, particularly, I mean, this whole discussion is really about football and men's basketball. Gender equity, yes, is very important. I got a daughter who's a big-time swimmer. I know maybe she'll be at Columbus School for Girls. So I know. And I grew up in a house full of women. I have three older sisters and a single mom. So I get all of that. But we also have to think, you're not treated differently. When you go or you get into the clubs, you get into this and all that, you're treated totally different than the regular student body. So I think the notion of equity and fairness and all this, I don't really know how you do it. So I say, look, if you're gonna pay players, which I'm against, but if you're gonna do it, it has to be a tier system. Now, the number 34 jersey, I made a lot of money for this university. They made a lot of money off me, and I wasn't on scholarship. I paid my own way. But, yeah, I know, right? I know, right? What were you thinking? Well, I knew I was going to the league, too, Sean. I knew that, right? I knew I was going to the league. But it's not, and we want to be fair, particularly in this society today. No, it's not fairness. It's not based on, it's really your value proposition. What do you bring to the table? And I think we want to be fair, right?
Yeah.
But we really can't be with this whole discussion. So I think there are some things that we can do, and we have to separate and look at it, because other sports, they know, particularly if I'm babysitting a kid and I partied a lot, but if I'm babysitting, if I'm hanging out, if I'm partying, especially now, I gotta be careful somebody don't take a picture of me and post it on Twitter or whatever. Mm-hmm. But if somebody who's not in a, you know, revenue generating sport or whatever, they can be a little bit more risk taking, right? So it's not really a fairness issue. And I think football and basketball, and most of the time, you're pushed and you're steered to meaningless degrees. I knew from coming in, you're not going to tell me what I'm going to take. I'm going to take, and not only that, though, when somebody says jump, I'm not going to say how high. I'm going to say for what. That's me. That's just how I look at things. But I made sure that Lawrence Funderburk was going to have some substance and some value beyond a basketball player. And I've always had issue with people. Yeah. If you saw me only as a basketball player, I would treat you like you didn't even exist. That's how I was. That was me. I would treat you like the Black Plague, okay, or like you had leprosy. But if you took me seriously for my intellectual capabilities, let's have a conversation. We can go there. But we don't value young people's, particularly athletes, their intellectual capabilities. We say you can do everything from the neck down, but from the neck up, that's really not important to us. And until we make it a priority, I think Sean said, as far as parents, alumni, they have to advocate for the kids. Because that's where the money is, right? Their kid coming to school and then alumni giving all this money. But until it becomes an issue of money, like Marie says, and people really know, this whole issue, we're going to talk about over and over and over again. And if nothing gets done, I don't want to be a part of it. Don't call me, don't invite me, because if my time is too valuable. And we keep going around this mountain, but nothing keeps being done. And we want to say everything's fair. Everything is not fair in life. It doesn't work that way. Whatever you bring to the table, that's what you should get paid.
Yeah, but I think it's two different issues, right? There's two different issues. There's an academic issue, whether these guys should go through school and have a certain type of curriculum and getting paid, right? I think we kind of jumbled it a little bit in the second group. Let's separate that. Let's make sure that's totally different. I think there are some courses that guys from we started a program, I think it was majority one here at Ohio State when I was in school, and it was junior athletes. They were advisors or mentors to freshmen or guys coming from Detroit, D.C., Chicago, California, wherever these guys were. And we were just trying to mentor those guys, and that was a majority one program. I think there are – I wish there was economics for sports when I was in school. I would have took that class. And I think there can be some classes tailor-made for guys who might struggle. But I think it's – you know, we break that cycle and we tell people that, hey, man, take athletics serious. And I mean, academic serious, and if you can't, then we'll get you more help, and we build the curriculum to it. Hopefully, we just don't push you through the program. On the pay for play or get paid for your value there, there's a complete difference between a guy who's a starter, all American, and a guy who wants to be that and who's coming up. I think that we can make it fair. I think we can make it fair that everybody gets a stipend for all sports, because some of my best friends were wrestlers. Kevin Randleman, yep. You remember Lawrence. Kevin was in school with us this past, and that guy took me under the wing. He took me under his wing, and he showed me a lot on campus. I would hate to see the wrestling program go away, or women's lacrosse, or whatever. I had some volleyball players I know too, but. But for the most part, I think it should be spread out. On the money side, I think it can be spread out. And then if you're close to making that decision, I know for me, when it came down to making that decision as a junior, I went to the bank, gave me a disability policy, and they rated me. And it was like, well, you're going to be a top five pick, so we can give you a $5 million. So I think that might be a way to do it through as a third party, let the insurance companies value what you're worth and how you get money, right? That's what happened for most of the guys. I think the kid out of Notre Dame who hurt his knee, the first-round pick, he had a $5 million insurance policy. Even though he might not be drafted in the first round, the more he can collect on that insurance policy. So that's my thoughts behind it.
I think you should be a full-time student. I think it's important. I think there is something out there called as progress towards your degree. I think where you really need to focus it is that it really is progress towards your degree. So when I went, it was still quarters. It was a 12-hour minimum per quarter. Inherently doable, in my opinion. Inherently doable. I never took less than 17 hours because I was always panicked that if I had to drop a class, I could, and I could still be eligible.
Yeah.
And when I took 22 hours in a quarter, I got my best grades because there was no dilly-dallying. I couldn't go fiddle-fart around with my friends. You had to really pay attention. So I think you do need to be a full-time student, but you need to make sure that the classes you're requiring people to take, however you want to define progress toward a degree, is something that people really do feel like they're learning in, and it's benefiting them. That makes it a heck of a lot easier to go to class when you actually think that you're learning something out of it instead of sitting there and someone speaking, you know, Russian to you. Full-time student, real progress, real classes that maybe we redefine what progress toward a degree is.
Yep. Thanks.
So I'm glad. I came in here, 8 years ago, 7 years ago maybe, and I'm working for the education department over there I'm teaching their golf twos, and then in the process developed a course called Golf for Business and Life. It got developed because the PGA program that they have here that hasn't got it certified yet, I believe, needed the course, so I told them I would take care of it and did it. And basically what we do is we take golfers out. And I have a lot of football players that take this course, basketball players, hockey players, wrestlers, seeing a huge influx of women right now. And we take them on the golf course. We teach them how to play golf, but we also teach them how to do business on the golf course. And we bring in people like you guys, business people, to talk to them about, number one, how important education is, because you can't be an athlete for your entire life. Most people can't anyway. And a lot of kids have gotten jobs that got hurt, didn't make it. They come back to Nationwide and you know, I have a good relationship with them, and, you know, they've gotten a job. So, you know, it's one of those things where this is such a hard thing, because you've got, like, different economic backgrounds, like they said. And I think that in time, something great will come, a positive person try to be. Something in time, it'll all hopefully be fixed and be equitable again for football, basketball, women's golf, women's tennis, women's basketball, all the sports that we offer here. Because I guess the last thing I would hate to see happen is we lose what this great university offers. And it is great. I can tell you, walking in anywhere I go, and the first question sometimes out of most people's mouth is, where'd you go to school? The Ohio State University. That holds more water than anything I can tell you about. That is so impressive to a lot of people. They didn't know I barely graduated, but, you know, that's okay. You know, I have a degree, and I think it was called recreation, and I took recreation. What was it called back then? Recreation? Leisure sports now. It was called something different before then. But I was in one of those, you know, here, Kelly, you're going to take this, you know. And I wanted to be a phys ed teacher, but not going to happen with my situation. So, you know, I understand where everybody's coming from, and, you know, it is a tough call for all of us to figure out where we need to be, and there are so many differences. So I'm hoping that maybe if we cut everybody's money off and bring everybody to the table, something great will come. I don't know.
I'm going to ask one last question, and if you guys answer it quickly, I'll have one after that. But I want to applaud the impassioned plea for free market economics, whether I come to any conclusion about what that means. But for the economists in the audience, that was excellent. the last question is, I'll start with John, actually. John drove here. He's a high school football coach, drove here with some students. So almost all of you have mentioned that you came here with different backgrounds and different issues out of high school. And many of you, probably all of you, spend a lot of time, and you've brought it up, speaking to kids in high school. What can we do to help kids in general, but athletes in particular, prepare them for what faces them when they come into a situation like you all did? You can start, John. I'm picking on you.
Well, the reason why I decided to go to the high school level and be a coach was I saw kids, you know, get the opportunity to come play college football at the Ohio State University. And, you know, 6-7 months later, grades are terrible. So I figured that they weren't prepared in high school. I mean, it all starts in high school pretty much as far as getting these kids prepared to go to the next level. So the reason why I took the job was specifically that to do my part as a person in society to make a difference. And I wanted to start there because at the end of the day, they're the future. I'm done playing football and kind of happy I am because I got to see, I get to see the business side of athletics. And I teach them every day, listen, academics. So I started, got hired back in December of 2015, this past year. First thing I came in there, started 5:30 a.m. workouts. So you guys were at 5:30 a.m. workouts. Oh my gosh. But first thing, first semester, I'll say the first 9 weeks I got there, I said, hey, I made an announcement. I said, I want every single kid that plays football to bring their report card to me. So I sat them down in the classroom, went through each and every one of their report cards in front of their teammates. So it's not a issue of, no, oh, y'all got an A. No, you got a C in that class, so don't try to lie. So I made it an issue to make sure these kids are getting their academics, because at the end of the day, you don't play football forever. You don't play basketball. You don't play any sports. Your academics is probably the thing that's going to hold you over the most, over the long haul. So I made sure as a high school coach, and these parents, I just actually came from a parent meeting last night, and that's why I couldn't make the dinner, because I want to make sure I have these parents very, very involved in what's going on. So this summer, I know Mr. Correa talks about having camps and stuff like that, but I want to have a camp for the kids, for the youth, so I get these parents to understand that, you know, it's not all about sports, but making sure these kids have their academics at the end of the day, because sports does not last long. your body only can take so much. And coming to a school like Ohio State where it's a grind. Every night and day you're working. And your body takes a toll after a while. So I wanted to make sure I took a job as far as helping high school kids and kids in the youth as well to understand that, you know, I think every kid I speak to, I say, what do you want to do in the future? I want to go to the NBA. I want to go to the NFL. But NFL stands for not for long. So you got to figure out something else. Because at the end of the day, if you have a family, you know, and you get an opportunity, get blessed to go to the NFL, NBA, you have all the money coming in, but then when your contract's up, what are you going to do? Because those bills, they don't matter. Those bills going to still come in at the end of the day. They're not going to stop because your NFL contract's up. They're going to still come in regardless. So we got to make sure. I'm making sure as a coach, I educate these kids as far as being smart and making sure that they do the right things at the end of the day.
I think it's the whole panel can agree that we all love to give back, whether it be from our, you know, communities we're from and just kids that we meet along the way. But I believe that can start before we graduate or before we leave our universities. The NCAA doesn't allow us to go get paid for public speaking, and I think that is completely wrong because so many people want to hear what we have to say and our experiences as we're going through it, but then it's like, oh, you can't get paid for it. Well, how about we start helping these kids while we're actually going through, while we're in college and what we're learning? And then once we get out and, you know, we're coaching or training, whatever it may be, we can continue to help them. But I think allowing student athletes to do that, speaking engagements, clinics, camps, whatever it may be, while they're in school would definitely help them supplement their income. Instead of we're being told, we can't do this, we're on TV, we're in the paper, you know, you're like royalty where you come from, but then we can't make money off of it. So I think I'm not for paying college athletes, like giving them a check on top of their scholarships, but I think that's a way that they could make money, allowing them to do that when people always want to have access to them and help them in some way they can.
I would tag along on that. People ask me every day, oh, Zeke this, Zeke that. People, I think that would be a great idea because they're the most influential people in the country, not the presidents, not the CEO of the companies. Student athletes are the most influential people in the country at the end of the day, especially for our youth.
And you're exactly right. Oh, man, if I'd have got paid for speaking engagements back when I was in college, man, that'd have been some nice change right there. you asked about young people, and I've worked with young people for 20 years, started a youth organization with my wife, the Lawrence Fund Mark Youth Organization, started a for-profit initiative I'm actually a free market guy, but I'm really about compassionate capitalism. And that's
that works, man. That's right.
And when I talk to young people, what I do is I show them the U.S. debt clock, usdebtclock.org, and I walk through every line item. I'm a guest lecturer at universities, was offered a full-time teaching position at a local college here. I turned it down because of the pay, but I love teaching, educate, and I walk young people through every line item, and I say, look, this is where we are fiscally. We talk about deficits as our country, a lot of deficits with student athletes, and I walk them through, and I go line by line and explain, this is where we are fiscally as a country. This is why it's so important for you to have a playbook or a game plan for your life. Everything that we've been talking about really is about life skills. Where is a life skills class? It should be a sanctioned class, a curriculum. Right, where you get a grade, or maybe you just make it pass fail, whatever the case may be. There should be some type of life skills, because everything that everybody keeps saying and things I've been doing for 20 years, life skills, life skills, life skills. I'm even working with life skills with adults who don't know and haven't learned a lot of these things. So I think if you show them where we are as a country, then I think sometimes emotionally you shock and awe, and then you hit them with a little intellectual stimulation. That's really my playbook.
Any other comments on how we can help the high school kids get ready for what athletes in particular, for when they show up here?
Once again, I wanted to clear this up. I'm not like a person, like I'm like, hey, I hate camps, but I've said it before that if you didn't do any more camps in any black communities around the country, I wouldn't be mad. Being for basketball, football, I would more take the approach of what Lawrence was talking about. I wish, and what I do myself, I promote the hard work, the teamship, the leadership, the discipline, the pace, and those things. But I don't tell any of these kids when I'm actually out there teaching them and coaching them that, hey, the NFL or the NBA is a possibility at some time. It's just a basic discipline that they may not receive from home, in particular the young black men. That's more my approach. And I always showed them that I'm an entrepreneur, you know, and I always showed them that, you know, I always make the illustration when I'm here in Columbus. I say, you know, if you go to Upper Arlington, New Albany, or you go to these more affluent communities, how many athletes do you have there? And they'll say none. And the whole notion is like, hey, you can get, ultimately, this is what you want to do. You want to take care of yourself. Everybody in this room of some sorts wants to be in a position to take care of themselves. You play I play football to get out the ghetto. That's it. You know what I'm saying? And it didn't matter what it was. Whatever had helped me to get out, you know, or to facilitate that lifestyle I wanted, I would have did, and I would have been attracted to. It wasn't like I had a passion for football. I just liked to lift weights, and football was cool for me. You know what I'm saying? And so for these kids, I just say, hey, just take the basic disciplines, the life skills that Lawrence was talking about, but understand what they are. You can capture that and channel it and go into any other direction you want. But like anything else, it's like being exposed to other things that you can basically attach that discipline to. And so not saying I'm against camps, you know what I'm saying? Totally not saying that, but saying, you know, the promotion, you know, like, hey, this is more about discipline and structure and learning how to take advice from a man and learning how to, you know, be disciplined and interact culturally with other people. It's more about that than, you know, catch a football and put a YouTube video up or an Instagram video up and all that nonsense.
That's a good point.
Well, I have to pipe in on this just a little bit here. you know, I do coach a lot, and I coach in Upper Arlington, and you know, those kids have different problems. Okay, being, you know, the silver spoon. They don't have a balanced checkbook. It's a give. I have two children that, you know, I'm trying to bring up a little differently in Upper Arlington, but, you know, give. And, you know, I think through your life skills program, these kids don't know how to balance a checkbook. They don't know how to do some of the things that you're talking about. I mean, it's kind of sad. But, you know, you try and stress to these kids coming out is, you know, life isn't going to give you cherries all the time. You can get a lot of lemons, and you better figure out how to deal with it. And that's where you guys could teach them a lot.
That's
because, you know, they do. They need to understand that. My two, I'll speak for my two particularly, you know. I mean, they wanted to gut a bathroom recently and have me pay for it. And after I found out what that cost, I said, I'm sorry, that's not in my budget. And I said, figure it out for yourself. And they took 4 days. They were off 4 days of school. And they demoed a bathroom, 12 years old. And they did it. And you know what? That's a life skill. That's something that they learn. You can't pay for everything. I mean, you've got to learn to do these things. So, you know, I think we have issues in all cultures.
Yes.
Yeah.
Economics.
Deficits. Okay, we're almost out of time. So I'm going to, and Maurice has already answered this question, I think. But I'm just going to close by asking for a vote from the panel members. If there weren't 90,000 people in Ohio Stadium tomorrow, and there weren't scholarships, this is speaking as a former Division III athlete, would you have continued to play your sport in college because you love the sport, or not? So, show of hands.
Yeah.
Okay, I think that says a lot. And I don't want student athletes to lose that passion for their sport because we make it too much of an issue and too much of a business. And I think that's true for I mentioned the 500,000 NCAA athletes. I think that's true for virtually all of them. So I will close with that. And I think you guys did an awesome job. So I really appreciate it. Mm-hmm. And now I think we have questions from the audience.
Real quick before we go to that, I know not everyone is here at the intro, but I want to thank everyone for coming because it was an amazing day. Social science is behind a lot of the sports and society initiatives, so my faculty in econ and communications and sociology, political science, and psychology, and so I really, they're the backbone of this program, which we just launched this year, so to have an event like this within a year is very rewarding. I also want to tell you a little bit more broadly and to reassure the panelists in some ways about what sports and society wants to do. Certainly it's panels like this where we're addressing what we think are some of the most important issues that intersect with sports and society today. But we are also developing curriculum here. So Nicole Kraft has a new media and sports class. We have economics of sports. We have sociology and sports. We also at Ohio State University are looking at revising the general education curriculum, which hasn't been revised, I think, since 1987. And so part of that is talking about exactly the kind of life skills classes that you're talking about. My colleague, Dean, over in education and human ecology is very much interested in this finance course of being part of our general curriculum. Generally, that's kind of like a third rail in academics. You don't talk about what everybody's going to take. But President Drake has embraced and has been talking about being bold and doing exactly that. So I think there's some reason to be optimistic there. I also want to let you know another important part of sports and society is talking about careers for students who have a passion for sports who aren't going to be going to the NFL or the NBA, et cetera. Greg Strizek, one of our alums who came back and gave a talk about our new major in data analytics, and we have a social science track that just got approved this year and bringing alums back like Greg to talk about how to have careers to harness that passion for sports is important. And then the bedrock is really our faculty research that we're doing on these issues. And we're very much bringing students in on that. So one of our alums, Barry Gluck, has put together a research grant for this summer for Chris to work with a student athlete, Carolina Vergosen, who's going to be working one-on-one with Chris. And it's these kind of mentorship relationships that they can get in at Ohio State that make a big university small that I think can make a real difference. And the big key to me for social science and sports and society to launch well are our alums who are a part of our board here. So that includes Jim Trelevin, Barry Gluck, Kristen Watt, Marcella Packer, Greg Strizek, and Matt Mitten. They've just been real fundamental in helping me think through issues that I wouldn't be well equipped to do without them. So I appreciate their time and commitment to sports and society. And with that, Trevon, you wanna take some questions?
Is this great? So we wanted to hear from you because we know that a lot of ideas have been floating around this morning. I believe we have two microphones to allow us to facilitate questions from the audience. We're first gonna hear from Matt Coppedge, who is coming from Representative Joyce Beatty's office for a little bit more of the political side of this debate. Matt.
Thank you all very much for having me here. On behalf of the Congresswoman, I do wanna say hello. Ohio State is always a very special and dear place to her. This is the heart of her district, the 3rd Congressional District of Ohio. So unfortunately, she's in Washington just finishing up votes. I'll be heading to the airport after this to pick her up. But thank you to all the panelists for both panels this morning and to all of you for such an interesting topic. The Congresswoman is the lead Democratic sponsor of legislation called the National Collegiate Athletics Accountability Act, or the NCAA Act. And this bill amends Title IV of the Higher Education Act of 1965, and it does a lot of things. One, it requires annual baseline concussion testing for student-athletes before they participate in contact sports. That's something that's very near and dear to the Congresswoman, is traumatic brain injury. It also enforces certain due process procedures for student-athletes when it comes to infractions and rules violations. It requires athletically related student aid to be guaranteed for the duration of the student's attendance, up to 4 years, and makes it irrevocable due to skill or injury. And it also permits institutions to pay stipends. There's some other things it does, but those are kind of the highlights. That's also why I had to bring the cheat sheet with me, because it does so much. The main impetus for this legislation, and with her bipartisan colleagues that she is working on this with, is to really make sure that for student athletes, that we're getting back to and closer to academics. You know, athletics is great, and she wants you know, student athletes to pursue that. She's an avid Ohio State football fan herself, but they are student athletes at the end of the day. And many of you on both panels talked about how important the academic side is. So my question to both panelists is, and I know that you touched on this a little bit, so kind of asking you to elaborate is, do you think that paying student-athletes would enable to bring the system closer to being able to focus more on that academic side, or if it doesn't, why not?
I think it would take away from the academic side. I would fear that student, young kids playing sports, I'll use basketball for an example, would start looking at it where, oh, I want to get paid to do this, you know, and not looking at it more so, I want to get my education. You know, so many different structures we've heard about today. Oh, I'll get paid $10,000 for a season. Well, that might be where their mindset is. You know, instead of, you know, getting my degree, finishing college, and moving on from there, it's all about the money now. And I think that would be very negative for, especially how youth sports are now. I think that they would be starting to think that like that very, very young.
I think the opposite. Then I think it would make you. I honestly think it would alleviate some pressure that these athletes face. We talk about, you know, it was a basketball player at UConn who was starving. So I think a lot of times, if it was, now I'm not saying paying $20,000, but I think there should be a gradual approach, some type of stipend that can take the pressure off them. I mean, there's some kids in the inner city would love to just be able to fly their grandmother up to one game because she's never been out of Tuscaloosa, Alabama, right? I mean, I'm just an example. And I'm not saying it has to be a huge, huge amount, but something probably a little more than what they currently get.
I mean, I'm the same way, and I was gonna definitely chime in, but I don't think it's anybody's place to care how an athlete should feel if he gets money or not. You know, we get some sort of money right now already, or the young kids, they get a stipend, but like, you shouldn't care how much this person is making or where their folks will be at. There's a lot of people who go into different degrees and different professions for the money, or they do what they do based upon money, period. And so to say just because he's an athlete and he already gets a scholarship because he plays football or basketball, whatever it may be, and he'll be focused on that, like, so what? Who cares if he's focused on that? You know, when Sean came, he said, I was focused on going to the NFL. That's my only focus when I was
here. I wasn't focused. I knew that. Yeah. let me correct that. That was my only focus, but I had an idea. Probably after my sophomore year, I was.
Well, let me speak high. For myself. Right. I played one game, I did well, I'm going to the NFL, I can care less about anything else going on here. Right. Like, that's where my head is at. So to say, like, we give him money and we care about it, like, that's a totally different kind. Those are personal feelings towards athletics and feeling privilege. The fact that he has a value to the university, I think, is something totally different, and a value towards what's being generated. That's all I'm saying. And just like Lauren said, the irony of Lauren saying, hey, I don't want to go to these places because I'm not paid and I got a valuable, my skill set and my education, my information I have to give to people is valuable. It's the same thing student athletes saying. I'm valuable, so let me be valued and give me what I'm worth.
Well, but that brings up a different point. If you, like, if you know a guy is a junior year and he's going to make $5 million, that could cause some friction among the players too. Mm-hmm. So I think.
What you mean?
Meaning like, okay, Maurice Corrett, you on a team and you starting tailback, I'm the starting corner, we both have egos, and you might say, I'm going to NFL, and I might be like, I'm top three pick, you're not going to make more money than me. That's a whole different psychology when you talk about the brand. Because let me face it, that's why it's important to understand, like, one, we want to be fair because you want to have the VCUs. I live in Virginia. You want to see the VCUs and stuff. You don't want to be totally crushed by the Dukes of the world, right? So even though it's not fair, you want to give those guys a chance at basketball. But when you're talking about in college, one thing I will tell anybody who comes into the Ohio State program, there's nobody bigger than that program. As good as you are, we'd have had 20 guys like you. Mm-hmm. As good as I am, we've had 30 guys, and I can name them from Neil Cozy to Jack Tatum. We're going to continue to have them because it's part of that brand of Ohio State. It's a greatness. Everybody in this room, because this brand is great. Mm-hmm. So nobody's bigger than that program. But I do believe that we should get some type of compensation. And if I know I was going to get drafted high, maybe you're right. I could have an insurance policy that pays me or put into an annuity account for when I do leave school, just in case of something like that. That's all I'm saying. And I think, I don't know if it was Joe or whoever talked about earlier, if you could possibly get some money for your appearances, maybe it goes into account, but you can't access everything. It's a lot of guys out of control. If they got 50,000, I'm telling you guys, with football players, we have bigger issues. Like volleyball players, we having kids. It'd be a whole bigger issue. These guys driving around with Mercedes. Y'all joking. I'm dead serious. You talk about Lawrence, you talking about life skills. These guys be out of control with 80,000, 100,000 miles on campus. It's the truth. Be calling your attorney.
Right. We want to thank.
Can I say something real quick? And Congresswoman Beatty, we're neighbors. So for her to say she's an avid football fan and not basketball, too, I'm going to have to get her for on that. So that's number one. Okay. All right. Now, she also said, we're pretty close, and I talked to her a lot about our curriculum and what we've done. And she also said that
particularly as black folks, we need to be on both sides of the cash register, meaning we need entrepreneurship skills, we need life skills, we need all these different skills that we need as well. And there has to be some type of mechanism or tie. Again, I'm against paying players, but I think if you are going to do that, then you have to have some type of prerequisite in order to get that or have access to that money. Again, you can't handicap these players, right? You can't continue to do that. You have to put them in a better situation than when they first came to this university.
Yeah.
That's mandatory. So there has to be some stipulation involved. I would love to see her legislation to add some other layers in addition to what she proposed there. That would be my take. And I just knock on her door. All right, she's coming in town. I'll see her tonight.
We have our first question.
Thanks so much, Eric Choi, the Ohio State University Office of Student Life. Good to see some of the colleagues on the panel that I know, Sean, especially with the majority one. Quick question for you. I'm also an alumnus of the sport management program here. Back in 96 and represented professional athletes in the Atlanta market around the marketing and branding. Want to dial it back to what we need to do in middle school, in elementary school.
That's right.
It's not high school, it's not on a college campus. We know the research that it starts by the third grade.
That's right, there it is.
By the third grade. To my friends here from the media standpoint, ESPN, ESPN Magazine and others, the imagery, especially for black males, that we see in imagery, we need to see more ownership that looks like us rather than playership. So I think in the curriculum aspect, we need to incorporate how to become an owner, not just a player. Or maybe should I say it? Ooh.
I'm fine, I'm embarrassed.
How do we do both in terms of the balance? So my question for the panel is, how do you continue to reach back in the household to talk about by the third grade or the fifth grade, they understand what is required, not Pee-wee, AAU, but what is the aspect that we look at? So way before they come to a college campus,
right,
there's a level of expectations, and if you don't meet the bar academically, no pads, no grades, no pads. So I just want to address that, but I want to commend the administration here for the launch of the program. Count me in to support the efforts as a product for this great institution. Thanks.
Now you said third grade. Most people don't know this, and this should make you feel outraged, regardless of your ethnicity. To determine how many prisons to build or how many beds to make available in prison, they look at the test scores of third grade black males. Let me say it again. Wow. Say it again. They look at the third grade test scores of black males to determine. Because they're saying if Pookie and Ray Ray are messing up in third grade, let's just go ahead and get his bed ready for him when he's 18, because that's more than likely. I go into juvenile facilities all the time and talk to these young kids. You're talking about deficits. They got a lot of deficits, all right? But you got to get back to here and go early in the process. At college, they should at least, like we're talking about dealing with some of these deficits, okay? But these deficits start way back here. And between the ages of 9 and 13, a kid already makes up in his or her mind what they want out of life, whether or not they want to do the right things or the wrong things, all right? Between the ages of 9 and 13. Okay, that's just based on research. So we have to really, really think about how can we do some preventative stuff so that kids don't have these deficits continue. And then in the pros, they're perpetuated when you get money even more. So we've got a whole issue, not just athletes, it's much bigger than athletes, okay? But how do we, because I would tell people all the time, I tell wealthy people all the time, millionaires, I say, look, we're gonna pay at the front end or the back end, but one way you're gonna pay. So you can support organizations, other organizations, or you can pay at the back end. Welfare, incarceration, how you want to pay, let's do it. So we have to really think about this issue because it's about athletes. We've all been blessed with our athletic ability, but what about the kids who can't play any sports, who will never be able to play at the big time level? Do they not still enjoy a shot at life? Of course, of course.
Matt, you had a comment?
Oh, I was just on that first question on should athletes be paid? I think it all, if you're a college athlete, it's got to be tied to either your educational achievement or the educational benefits you're providing to others. Marcel, I loved your proposal. The idea is, why shouldn't the NCAA permit, you know, college athletes to go out and get paid? You can make a huge difference there. And in my mind, it all comes back to what Coach Woody Hayes said. If anyone's read his book, it's called You Win With People. And he says in there, he says, well, you try to get everything you can out of the athlete in terms of football, but the athlete who doesn't earn his degree has been cheated. And that's true across the board, you know, really for all sports. And I think that's what we really should get back to is there's plenty of money out there. It just needs to be you know, rechanneled for the right reasons.
But it depends on your degree. A lot of degrees, I hate to say it, they're meaningless. A degree has to be something substantive that you can use. So we can't just push a degree just to get a piece of paper. It has to have some value to it.
Yes.
Yeah, I would agree as an educator. I mean, I don't think you should channel athletes necessarily into other things. I mean, you've got music degrees, art, all kinds of things. It's just creating something that provides valuable life skills and whatever they're going
to
do.
I think it goes back to also if you tell a kid they're dumb, they're dumb.
That's right.
If you tell a kid that they're smart, they're smart. And, you know, I was one of those kids that they told me I was dumb. And you know what? Not so dumb. So, you know, I think it goes back. I love what Lawrence is doing. It's amazing. So it's a great program, but he's right. I mean, education, I think, is everything to get us to the point where we get to where we're at, you know, where we need to be.
Hi, Rob Aller, Columbus Dispatch. Sean, you touched on this, but I'm just curious the whole dynamic in the locker room. When you talk about tiered pay, it's one thing to be 30 years old in the NFL and a guy's making $10 million, another guy's making $2 million. But for 18-year-old kids, if one guy's making $40,000 and one guy's making $1,000,
right.
What's the dynamic in the room? How does that play out in terms of team and product?
And that's why I don't believe it should be a tiered pay. I believe that all student athletes should get a stipend that amounts to the same, however you divide that up. And then there's a guy like Maurice Corrett who has the jersey sales who probably can have that put away on the side to him that he could have access to at some point. Or, you know, as his junior year, if he want to be able to access at some point, be able to access that money. Because if you talk about putting in a locker room where a guy gets $50,000, $60,000 in, you know, and Maurice will tell you, don't even take money for a guy. I think he should be starting over this guy. You know, that really set the whole locker room off. And it just takes away from the teamwork, the discipline, working together. So I think in this, the star football player is not better than the star basketball player, golfer, or whatever. We all should get, whether it's a Big Five power conference. So the big things we need to do is, I believe, it's like set up a trust where you have guaranteed four-year scholarship, you got guaranteed lifetime disabilities, and you come up with a solution for stipends where the NCAA makes $2 billion or whatever, 20% of that goes and it just gets spread among the athletes and the guys who are special and their jersey is selling. For me, for us, matter of fact, I have to tell you the story about how Orlando Pace was stealing my cleats and selling them. but you're right. Guys should be able to sell their jerseys or whatever, be able to make money off the side. That might be put into account for those guys for when they, and I don't know what the legal ramification is behind it, but be able to set some aside.
And I mean, that's, to me, that's, that. After hearing you out, that's why I like people like to talk and explain everything. After hearing you out, that doesn't sound like a bad thing because I can see some of the potential things that you think about because right. I can visualize the locker room getting like yeah. that. But then also, I'm like in the realm of you can go to prison when you're 18, you can handle business at 18, you can do everything as an adult at 18. So it doesn't matter. Like this is what you're valued at. Right. Like so, if I'm smart and I'm Mark Zuckerberg at 18 and I understand Facebook, I can go earn as much money as I can because I can do it. You know what I'm saying? And so if you want to make a thought, like if you're a good lawyer, you're a bad lawyer, or if you're the bad lawyer, get better. You know what I'm saying? And like that's how I think about life in general. Like your value and your skill to a certain organization or situation, you should be compensated with it, and it shouldn't be held in the realm of, okay, from 18 to 22, since we're society and we think that college is supposed to be like this cool, great experience, we're going to set these expectations based upon how we feel that life should be lived. I just feel like if you can earn it, earn it. If you can't, you can't. Like everybody can't do the same thing. And that's my feeling on it. Cause just think about it. 4 years later, you shift into a different paradigm, a different consciousness because you're in professional sports, but nothing really changed. The whole system is the same. You know, you're playing with the same people, you're doing the same stuff. And okay, like what if they said, okay, the first 4 years of your league, you generate all this money for Jerry Jones or whoever. But since you're the first 4 years, you know, we teeter you or we feel that you should be appreciative to be in the NFL.
Mm-hmm. And the reason why I say you have to do it, because if you did that, then everybody would want to go to Ohio State and Alabama because they know they're going to generate the the most money because they own TV the most, and that kills college
sports. But it's the same thing with companies, right? You go to Google because Google has different benefits, and it's a major company. I just feel like that's life in so many different areas. You want to go to the biggest and best places where you can earn the most money.
Yeah, it sounds good until Ohio State wins the NCAA football tournament 25 years straight. It sounds good.
Exactly.
Just a couple of observations. In 1968, Sports Illustrated did a series of articles that were kind of landmark on the black athlete. And it just strikes me how little things have changed. They raised lots of issues that you have here, and it shows how institutions are very slow to change. It just takes a long time. I'd also like to compliment both panels. You've handled this well. It's obviously potentially emotional. I wish presidential debates could be as civil.
You got Bernie Sanders in the front.
Thank you all. I come from a different perspective. I'm a New York City kid. Back when I played basketball in college, I did, Lawrence, play basketball in college. With the guy that changed the rules on Lou Alcindor. How'd you like to be dunked on him every day getting out of gym? Back when we were in school, though, there was a freshman year rule which excluded us from playing varsity sports as a freshman. Do you people think that that would benefit? We're talking about the structure now, right? We're talking about poor people who have been born in places that make society difficult. Would that rule have given you, if we reinstituted that rule, would that have given you a better platform to build the rest of your career on? And Coach Holman, even back to the high school, we didn't have that really in high school, but specifically, would that have helped you formulate a plan for your development of your students as well as athletes at the high school level? Thank you.
Yeah, I think your freshman year is your hardest year by far. You're trying to find yourself. Yeah. You're told how great you are when you go to college. They wine and dine you, and then when you get to college, you're like, it's not really like that. It's totally different. And but I think you find yourself and you grow up. In the NBA, I think for the NBA, I think it should be mandatory 2 years that you should stay in college, because you have to find yourself, and it takes a little time to do that. So I think 1 year sitting out is totally different. It's a different era now, right? It's totally different. Kids are impatient. That wouldn't work in today's time.
That's right.
It's not a bad idea, but it's not. It wouldn't work in today's time. And by the way, Kareem was my favorite player back in the day, so I got a lot of love for Lou Alcindor. Yes.
Me. It wouldn't work because we don't suggest that.
Correct.
We got the tail wagging in the door. We've got a young fellow who's struggling in his family and in his society telling me, a grandparent, right, who's lived through that era, that I'm wrong and he's right.
Right.
I completely disagree. I've agreed with almost everything you said because you've made a trail that leads to success. I don't want a 16-year-old snot-nosed kid, no disrespect if there are any in the room, a grandfather who's lived that a whole entire life on how he should manage his life. That's what I'm here for.
Right.
My responsibility now as a member of society is to blaze a path for him, just like you're talking about.
Right.
Coach Holman is blazing a path for him. If a kid walks into him and says, I'm not coming to practice today because I can't imagine what his response is going to be.
Due to Ohio high school association rules, I can't say it's mandatory, but they need to be there.
There are repercussions, huh?
I can't really say that either, but they need to be there.
Because it's your responsibility, correct?
I agree.
Right. I agree. And I agree with you, Mr. Funberg. That's our responsibility as senior members of society. So if some snot-nosed kid comes and explains to me, that's not what I'm doing because, you know, I'm on Twitter or whatever this crap is that they're on. I can't even spell angry
about social media.
Right.
I got as many degrees as you.
Right.
Then I'm failing him in society, just like
you are.
Said. You're
that's true.
Him
it's true.
What this gentleman's talking about in the third grade. He's failing him in society if he's letting a kid go to the sixth grade. Mr. Florent said he couldn't read, all right?
Not very well. No, but I just know I can read.
Well.
I couldn't comprehend.
That's not his fault. That's your fault and my fault.
Right.
I'm his grandfather. I'm the one who's responsible for health this gentleman is responsible.
Right.
Yeah. So I don't want some snot-nosed kid telling me I'm not going to class because I got to go to the movies. Coach Holman, I hope you did what I would have did. That's why my kid graduated with honors.
He's got his head down, too.
And his sisters aren't even here.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. I mean, would they sit out for the, yeah, for the first year? It's not a bad idea to find yourself. But think about this for a second. These athletes are recruited, and they're predicted to come and make an immediate impact. I mean, yeah. You know, just imagine if Maurice Claire had to sit out that first year, right? When probably wouldn't have went to the championship, national championship. So the universities are not going to allow. I'm not saying it's not a bad idea, but it really is in many respects, unfortunately, about the money. You know, in terms of this. But I think it's not a bad idea to go back to that. But I think if you make it at least mandatory, the longer a kid stays in college, I think the better off they'll be in terms of understanding what life is like, right? What it's like. Oh, those of you who are parents, you understand. We have hindsight. And I think that's what we need to do here is we have hindsight. And we've got to be sensible and at the same time understand the needs of today's young people.
Thank you for hearing me. And I want to say that both panels, the first one and this current one, were very compelling. I just was speechless, hardly know where to begin, so in about 3 minutes, I just want to say, Lawrence, you have a passion that must go paid or unpaid, because you have an electric presentation, and I think it haunts you in a way that I think you need to continue it, whether you get paid or not, because you have a lot of great direction. Don't demand a paycheck for such excellence. It will come to you. All things come to those who give the most to other people, do they not?
Absolutely.
Maurice, my heart hated your guts after the mistakes you made, but I loved you on the field, but I love you now. Because I got to say, you've come a long way. I think you were haunted by LeBron just ahead of you and the money that he made not even going to college. And I think that was a tremendous pressure that speaks to not paying athletes, because you were so focused on the burning desire to make the cash. I heard you just say a minute ago, if I played one football game and I knew I did well, I was going to go to the NFL. It was not about what I was going to do 50 years later, 40 years later, or raise my children. It was about get me LeBron's paycheck. Was it not at the time?
You're wrong.
Okay. I stand corrected. It looked like that from a distance, and I think the two people beside you spoke to me clearly on. They came to college knowing they probably wouldn't have a multi-million dollar career, and I think you could taste one, and I think it haunts you.
Just to clear it up so there's clarity for you, I understood that if I go and play for a year, I can get life-changing money. We're talking about at this time, for top four, five, six picks, they're paying $20, $30, $40, $50, $60 million to, right? Through circumstance, through me living in Youngstown and LeBron living in Akron, he was my buddy. The fact that he went to the NBA, I'm proud for him. That's great and everything. But at the same time, you should probably go watch the 30 for 30 documentary that his two sons did. I didn't leave college early because I wanted a paycheck. I left college because the athletic director who was here had formulated some circumstances that basically I couldn't basically be successful in. When I was suspended from the football team for taking money to fix a transmission, for getting a cell phone bill paid for from high school and into college, basically I was suspended indefinitely. They took away the SASO department, which basically helped me together academically. They required me to get a 3.0, and there was a lot of other circumstances. So I just wanted to inform you on that. I didn't want to go to the NFL for money. I wanted to go to the NFL because I had no other options. Also, I couldn't transfer to another university because I would have had to sit out for a year with the Division I sports. I think the first panel kind of spoke on it in depth in regards to if Urban Meyer wants to leave, he wants to go to Michigan next week, he can go and become a coach. So just to kind of clear that up, and so, you know, just you won't assume.
Can we give all of our panelists a big round of applause?
Thank you all. This has been wonderful. It will be on YouTube. We're recording everything. This is going to be one. Tell your friends, pass it on, tweet it. I think a lot of people are going to want to see this, are going to study what people have said here. And this is just the beginning. We're going to have more of this. We've got a lot of ideas. We're going to take that ball and run with it. Thanks again.